Ladies and gentlemen, we're live. It's Friday, the 15th of April, 2016. We've got a very important transmission lined up, but first, a key report from John Bowne.
The Panny are buying up underground bunkers and or fleeing to parts unknown, as all indications point towards a collapse that will, in the words of economist Peter Schiff, be the earthquake that follows the 2008 tremor. The Chicago Tribune reported that about 3,000 individuals with net assets of $1 million or more left Chicago in the last year alone due to the exploding climate of unrest growing in the union stockyards. The writing is on the wall. President Obama, in concert with his puppet master George Soros, have been turning up the heat on deteriorating conditions resulting from the United States and the EU's strategic collapse of the global economy for the last 7 years.
So if somebody wants to build a coal power plant, they can. It's just that it will bankrupt them because they're going to be charged a huge sum for all that greenhouse gas that's being emitted.
Before Obama ever came around, coal was doing good. Obama killed it.
We have citizens digging through the trash just to eat.
I wish he'd just step off the face of the earth. It wouldn't hurt my feelings none.
What's actually hurt coal is not any EPA rules as much as it is really cheap natural gas that has come from fracking.
They're fracking with such corrupt practices across the United States that the well water is catching on fire.
Whoa.
Soros signals Argentina's shale is biggest place to be. Soros doubled his stake in state-owned oil company in Argentina, while for the last 7 years spending tens of millions of dollars to lobby to shut down shale production in the U.S. by wildcat small companies. And I'm not saying shale fracking is good overall. I'm not saying there aren't problems, but most of it's financed by Soros and Saudi Arabia, who don't want us to have our own oil. So a coal plant in Mexico that's totally dirty is okay, but a coal plant in Texas that's clean is not okay.
And most of these frackers and oil sand people can't break even unless oil's over $80 or at least over $55.
That's
right. I think it's going to 10 to 20 in the next several years. So this is what they're doing is they're pumping their existing wells to the max to create cash flow, because their wells are not expensive to pump. It's expensive to find the darn things and drill. And they were only able to do that with the cheapest junk bonds in history because of quantitative easing and artificial stimulus and high oil prices. So that's the next thing to hit the United States.
The Wall Street Journal reports that the largest coal company in the United States has filed for bankruptcy, an event that will result in energy costs that will sharply rise on the American middle class like they have on the common people of Germany. Germany's energy policies have gradually doubled the average industrial cost per kilowatt hour, as clean and renewable energy can't carry the load, literally. Last week, Obama began pushing for housing lenders to offer home loans to people with bad credit. What better way to push the economy over the edge than to repeat the same 2008 nightmare?
We're using data on housing and neighborhood conditions to help cities identify the areas that need the most help.
By 2014, investors had already begun to notice another government-fed subprime housing bubble on the horizon. Investors Business Daily wrote in January of 2014, what stoked housing inflation was federal housing policies designed to boost home ownership among low-income and minority borrowers. Between 2011 and the third quarter of 2013, housing prices rose nearly 6%. Triple the increase in rental costs. Both this bubble and the last one were caused by the government's housing policies. Low down payments, a mere 5% at Fannie and Freddie, and just 3.5% at the FHA, are fueling the bubble. But new qualified mortgage rules don't require a minimum down payment for borrowers in 2014. The country has been misled about financial reform. InfoWars has called for Obama's impeachment on numerous occasions, to no avail. His supposed lame duck presidency, heading into the end of his term, has been tremendously underestimated. Americans are nothing less than under a full New World Order attack, aided and abetted by the executive branch of the United States of America. John Bowne for InfoWars.
It was George Berkeley that famously said, if a tree falls in the forest and no one is there to hear it make a sound, did it make a sound? Well, I'm here to give you the answer to that age-old question. Yes, it did. And if the American Republic had fallen and no one in the mainstream media told you, would the Republic still be dead? And the answer is yes. In 20 plus years on air, I've never seen a demarcation line that clearly shows to me the full collapse has basically already gone to a point where you can say this country is unrecognizable and we are rapidly accelerating into a nightmare totalitarian system. We've seen Priebus, the head of the Republican Party. We've seen the head of the Rules Committee, Curly Hewlin or whatever his name is, come out and openly say, listen, the media is wrong. You never had a vote. It doesn't count. The party picks whoever's there. You're just here at a fashion contest.
Political parties choose their nominee, not the general public, contrary to popular belief.
Then why bother holding the primaries?
That's a very good question.
Then when myself and Roger Stone and others came out and simply called for people to go protest and demonstrate and talk to the delegates, and we said, and don't be violent, in Cleveland coming up in a few months, they had all their pundits go on TV and say, maybe Roger Stone should be arrested. This is in a climate with all these incredible attacks on free speech, and it's really creepy.
We are a free society in America. We're not a third world country. We don't threaten violence against delegates, and I think that Reince Priebus and the RNC should move to ban Roger Stone from the convention, because we cannot tolerate threats and threats of violence.
They're also stealing states and delegates from Bernie Sanders. Ladies and gentlemen, they're telling you that they're allowed to make these rules, but they're taking public taxpayer money by the billions, and the counties and cities are holding out that we're having public elections where it's one person, one vote. There are federal and state election laws, like the 1965 Voting Rights Act, that's meant to block this type of racketeering. Even Jim Crow laws against poor blacks and whites were not this strict or this over the top. And I'll close with the words of President JFK. Those that make peaceful revolution impossible make violent revolution inevitable. And the power brokers know that, and they want to break our will and push forward and want a civil war in this country. Let's peacefully go out. Let's sue these people. Let's donate to political causes. Let's get involved. Let's have our minds heard. Let's expose these political party machines. Let's do everything we can to stop this illegal criminal takeover of America by a two-party system establishing an oligarchy or dictatorship in this country. As George Carlin said, it's a big club and you ain't in it.
I was just thinking about how they have this race going, in their own words, to merge with machines and become gods. And they've already decided in all the dominant literature that humans are obsolete and an ugly, bad thing, and that we're going to phase out the human race as it's known. That is the collective cosmology or belief system of the ruling establishment. They've taken over the world mainly through crony capitalism and combines. And now they're looking at everyone else eating up their resources that they believe belong to them, and they're setting up a system to phase out humanity as we know it. Now, obviously, I have stacks of news here to cover today, but why do I so often open with that general theme? Because that is what's happening. We're on a space rock. It's not that big. 7.5 billion of us hurtling around a sun at 30-something thousand miles an hour. And we look at these elites and these leaders who are just like leaders of old. They just have more high-tech weapons and more propaganda. They have the same hubris, the same megalomania, the same mental illness. And I see the amount of delusion and mental illness increasing in the general public. And it's admitted that mental illness is skyrocketing and delusional behavior, but I see it all around me. I've probably known personally 12 or 13 people, I was thinking about it this morning, in just the last 6 years that were normal and behaving normally, who went completely insane. Is it the water? Is it in the air? Is it the unnatural culture? We've heard about cabin fever in the cold winter when you're locked up, you know, at the North Pole for a month. Most people start going crazy. Heard about cabin fever on ships. Heard about space fever when people are out in space for a month or so. They start going nuts, even the strongest people. We're living in such an unnatural world. And I'm not bashing technology. I'm bashing some of the bad side effects of it. And I've used this analogy many times. It's like if you're on a Mars mission, a year and a half to get to Mars with the current technology. If they try to go to Mars at the right time in a cycle when the planet is closer to us, the fourth rock, that even the most healthy astronaut who could run, you know, two marathons back to back on Earth, when they get to Mars, will have to spend a few months basically being able to work out on the surface, slowly even be able to jog or lift up a 20-pound box. Russian cosmonauts that have been in space for a year, you know, have trouble even getting up out of their seats. Russia, last time I checked, has the longest time spent in space. I think one time somebody spent almost 2 years up there, and it showed when the capsule came down, they couldn't even get up. They had trouble breathing, had to give them oxygen. Their lungs couldn't even operate. And that's what it is with screen time and calculators and all these machines and buzzing this and buzzing that and smartphones. We're being encased in a control grid that dumbs us down, makes us unhealthy, makes us unhappy. People say, hey, hypocrite, you're sitting at the center of a high-tech news studio wired in like maybe only 0.1% of people are. I mean, this is like per square foot, got more computers and wires and antennas than the Pentagon. I get it. I know. That's my point. How do you live in this and contain your humanity and keep it? And I've got a stack of news along that line today that we're going to be getting to, the way they're selling it. DNA analysis could help improve your workout, study finds. Reuters. My dad wanted me to talk about this like a month ago, and I never did. But I had him run back to my office and get it. Thank you, Nico. He went because he decided to go ahead and keep his dental license. And boy, that came in handy when my son, my dad's an endodontist and oral surgeon, a lot of other stuff. My son jumping on the trampoline with some at a friend's house, knocked his two front teeth out. And of course, if he'd gone to the emergency room, they would have just taken him. You know, they were like back at a 45 degree angle, basically out, hanging by meat. But my dad got him back in and looks like he'll be able to keep him, thank God. But long story short, he was going back to get his continuing education just to keep his license, just so he can work on the family a few months ago because his license was coming up. He retired via Obamacare because it's so immoral he refuses to be part of it. He was also managing several hundred medical clinics, and he got out of it, even though he was very successful, because, again, it's so evil. And that was the plan, you know, get all the good medical people out, and it's working well. Now he's bringing the foreign doctors and the rest of it and lower the standards. Not that foreign doctors are bad either. It's just they come from India or Eastern Europe. They're used to ration care. They're used to following orders. They're used to not having a Hippocratic oath. But I digress. They're used to socialism. And he was in several days of a continuing education. And most of it is about the DEA and prescriptions and this rule and that rule and how to fill this chart out and all that garbage. And he said like half a day was on how everyone's going to have DNA chips starting in the next year or two, and how you won't give anyone a prescription unless they have a DNA chip. And then how in the next rollout, the DNA chip will communicate with chips in all of the pills, and that they're going to then basically have smart meters all over the place that are reading your bodies as you just walk down the street to see what you're on and then call the police on you. And by the way, I mean, I told people about license plate reading cameras 20 years ago and they didn't believe it. Now you know they're everywhere. It's the same thing. Here it is in business. Insider. I have another one on the London Telegraph. Smart mattress lets you know if your partner is cheating. See, chips are so cheap now that you pay $5 extra, $10 extra, and the smart mattress tells you everything you're on, what you've been doing, and if you've had sex with somebody else. See, they're enticing us into the spy grid. Just like I read 15, 16 years ago in AP, how they were coming out with the new light bulbs under mandate, and thank goodness they just so happened to work. No, they were designed that way. This is unity of agenda. This is standardized global rollout. That data over power lines would then send data through your power lines into your house and then into smart meters and smart interfaces and smart bulbs. And the bulbs would then communicate with different things in your house. And it also had a fringe benefit just accidentally, just like it accidentally, you know, just hooks into the grid and data. It accidentally can calm you during crises. And it will know when, just like the smart meters we told you 16, 17 years ago would tax you during key times and would control your thermostat. It's now being done in four states. Li-Fi, all of it. And this is what's so frustrating. I'm only scratching the surface. And this is all being rolled out like the elite are an alien force or something. Imagine a science fiction movie where they look like humans, but they have all this high tech and they're making it where everything from the TVs to the toasters to your mattress to your car is remote controlled by them, tracks you and taxes you to siphon off all your funds to their corporate reservations where they're actually building a breakaway civilization. That'd be a neat science fiction movie, wouldn't it? But that's what they're doing, and they're not aliens. They're crazy people who are inspired, if you go to Bohemian Grove, Skull and Bones in places, by Lucifer. Now, who's Lucifer? He's fallen to Earth. He doesn't like us. He wants to override creation and set himself up as God. That's what the Bible says. It's happening. A fallen entity who fell to this planet and is doing this to us. I mean, there's the answer. It's all real. It's really happening. And whether that Lucifer is real or not, the elite are doing it. They're building it. So I'm going to talk about this later in the broadcast. We got a bunch of guests coming up as well. But I want to do a whole report, too, on DNA chips. And again, the chip isn't in you. They take your blood once. It's then in a chip database. And then they can take your blood and prick you again whenever they want. It's just quick and easy, no big deal. And they got a bunch of different ones coming out. But MIT News, major step in implantable drug delivery device. Why pharma wants to put sensors in the blockbuster drug. Microchip implants medication on command. Scientific. And then this isn't the full one. Here it is. Lab on a chip technology for near patient diagnosis. This is Austin Publishing. This is what they were teaching them. Bioelectronic DNA chips for the clinical laboratory. And they're telling him when he went for his continuing education, as an endodontist, as an oral surgeon, they told him, oh yeah, this is what everybody's going to have. Just like they told my cousin, who's just got out of the Army at 35 years, 10 years ago, that troops were going to start getting chips, and they did start getting them. Special forces and people. And then it's classified, so they can't tell you. I mean, the chipping's already going on, and then it was in MIT magazine a few months ago that troops are getting brain chips. And it shows them putting brain chips in them. Now, of course, they're opting into the programs now. Soon it'll be mandatory. We got the big Trump news straight ahead. Stay with us.
We are witnessing an unprecedented coming out of the closet by tyrants. Barack Obama represents the top five megabanks and the Fortune 100 that are owned and controlled by this group. They are establishing an open world government where they are above the law. But at the domestic level, they want dictators or communist or fascist systems to control the population, to extract the wealth to the offshore combines that, again, are above the law, tax exempt, and have diplomatic and regulatory immunity. That's what President Obama was talking about a few weeks ago when he traveled to Argentina to say there's not much difference between capitalism and communism.
In the past, there's been a sharp division between left and right, between capitalist and communist or socialist. And especially in the Americas, that's been a big debate, right? You're a capitalist Yankee dog. And I think for your generation, you should be practical and just choose from what works.
The controlled corporate media no longer criticizes Cuba and its massive human rights violations, or China's intensifying violations, killing Buddhists and Falun Gong, peaceful people who weren't even protesting, and selling their organs that are chopped out of their bodies in mobile execution vans. 10 years ago, our government did criticize it. No more. And it's because our system is going totalitarian. This is the fall of America that we're witnessing right now. And that's why it's more important than ever that you use your First Amendment or lose it. InfoWars is the tip of the spear. Go to InfoWars.com/newsletter. Sign up for our InfoWars Insider so we can get past the censors and send you critical videos, articles, and other intel. There are so many ways for you to support InfoWars.com and get these critical articles and information out. We're already growing exponentially, but we need to turbocharge and go to the next level. Every day, sign off on your email, your Facebook, your Twitter with InfoWars.com/show. Send people the free podcast list. Send people the free iPhone and Android apps that are at InfoWars.com/show. People are ready to hear the truth. Visit InfoWarsStore.com to find thousands of items, the highest quality, the lowest prices on nutraceuticals and supplements, on shortwave radios, on non-GMO heirloom seeds, on powerful Second Amendment t-shirts, ball caps, Hillary for prison apparel, you name it. Now is the time to practice the First Amendment or lose it. Now, they're trying to take our right to vote away, but we also have the right of the free market voting with our dollars. And we can still change things by supporting institutions and organizations that tell the truth and support and promote basic free market Renaissance Americana values. That's why when you spend your money at InfoWarsStore.com and when you spread the word about the broadcast to everyone you know, you are an active participant in the second American revolution against the tyrants that have come in and occupied this nation. For all of you that have supported us, I want to thank you and ask you to increase your efforts. For those that have been on the fence but know this country's in trouble, I know I'm not perfect. Nobody is. But InfoWars has been the most effective and has got the best shot at really awakening the sleeping giant. So join us today. Support the InfoWar and be part of the solution.
We're going to have the crew on pre-demonstration there in Denver against the theft of the election by the Republican and Democratic establishment. It's at the RNC. Talked to Roger Stone yesterday. He begged the listeners. He said, please tell your listeners, get involved, take action, get in there, be part of this. And the good news is the media engaged in a giant, sickening psyop, but they gauge the public. And now it all collapsed starting yesterday. I monitor the news, obviously, as my crew does and many of you do. And I see in the controlled media their attempts in everything from the Washington Post to USA Today to MSNBC to CNN and Fox to normalize. Of course no one ever votes in primaries and the party appoints the nominee. That's never happened before. If that starts happening, then it's a dictatorship of an oligarchy. It's like the Chinese system, the Central Committee, and then the Politburo. Yes, you have people that represent the voters from the precinct who are pledged, and if it's neck and neck, then historically there can be some jockeying. I mean, Reagan won by a handy amount in the delegates, but they still try to take it from him. So that was the first time this got floated around. They put it on the books 4 years before in 76, but they tried it in 1980, and the threat was enough to get Reagan to put George Herbert Walker Bush
in the VP slot, and then Reagan got shot. The rest is history. We've had three rounds of Bushes, and now they want a fourth one with Ted Cruz. And it's with heavy heart I have to come out against Ted Cruz. I ignore all the Goldman Sachs stuff and the Bush connections, hoping that that's just how he came up and he was for real. No, he's a total operative. He's uncloaked in his arrogance. And I'm physically sick over it. I'm sick of betrayal. I want to believe in this country. I want things to get better. I want to believe in the government. I want to believe in the people. I'm tired of it. Where are the honorable people? And the good news is, starting about yesterday, I saw it shift, and even mainstream media went, and even Fox and CNN and others were like, as I monitor it, were like, yeah, I mean, people do want the popular vote to be counted. We better do it. You better not try that, because they realized no one was buying their PSYOP, that everyone wants open, you know, borders, everybody wants forced vaccines, everybody wants to be spied on, everybody wants to not have a vote. Of course you never vote. Like, well, why do we have primaries? Why did we vote before? Why'd you say we get the government we vote for? If I don't get to vote, then I don't get to pay taxes or follow your laws. You don't just sit up there over me. And so a stack of articles today in my stack. I mean, there's like 15 articles I came across without even looking. U.S. News and World Report. Sarah Palin says voters should decide GOP nomination. Wow, that's, man, what a weirdo. Voters? What are those? CBS News. Why the GOP can't take the nomination from Donald Trump. And it goes on and on. Cold greeting for Cruz at GOP gala. He's going down in the polls. New Yorkers ignore Ted Cruz at GOP gala. They've dropped the charges against Trump's former campaign head, still former but in transition, and now the witnesses are coming out that she was falling down drunk, stumbling around. It's just all made up. That's what these people do. So that's all coming up, and we're going to get into a bunch of clips, the latest on the election. And our crew was in New York yesterday. Now they're in Denver. We have a lot of footage. We can't play it here because all the cussing, because the anti-Trump people do not talk. All they do is cuss and spit and run around in circles. March, they attack people. It was amazing.
Alex Jones and it's the all coming up.
Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central, we are here broadcasting worldwide. That's 12 noon to 4 p.m. Eastern. What is that, 9 to 2 Pacific, 10 to... I'll tell you, there's just so much going on in this world, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm going to attempt right now to go over a lot of the news before all these guests start joining us. Let's go ahead and get back into the Trump right now. So I went over the fact there's a lot of news articles, mainstream news now saying, you know, you really need to go with the popular vote. This is not a contested deal. He's way ahead. He's going to be way ahead on the East Coast. What do you mean you're going to ignore the popular vote at Cleveland and maybe even give it to Paul Ryan or somebody else like Kasich? Because they don't really want Cruz either, even though he's establishment. He hasn't been around long enough, but they might go for that. Sarah Palin says voters should decide GOP nominee. Imagine you have to even say that in America. Voters should decide a nominee who's then going to run for president. Of course, we're voting on the Republican we want. If it's appointed by a party, then the parties will just get together and create a dictatorship, a rigged deal, which they're trying to do. I mean, they've been joined at the hip for a long time, but this is like them doing the deed in front of everybody. Associated Press, voters will rise up in opposition to Republican power brokers, try to take the presidential nominee away from Donald Trump or Ted Cruz at the GOP convention this summer, Sarah Palin said Thursday in a wide-ranging interview with the Associated Press. I didn't even say rise up. I said go demonstrate for our First Amendment rights, because that's what voting is. Jury rights, grand jury rights, the speech, the press, religion, it's all in the First Amendment. It's under some other amendments as well, but it's all inculcated there. Are they going to call her a terrorist, call for her arrest? I mean, Roger Stone didn't say rise up. And they're in the Washington Post, CNN, CNBC, MSNBC calling for his arrest. And playing clips of this show implying I'm violent. news articles that had me in there saying Jones wants a day of rage, violence. Is, you know, oh my gosh, we're so, oh yes, I'm so looking for violence. Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm.
I'm fighting to try to stop it. I'm trying to stop the George Soros-funded groups out there trying to start a war in the streets shooting police. I have Oath Keepers on that has a national initiative for Overwatch for citizens and police alike so that this doesn't continue. And it's not about groveling to the police. The globalists are taking the country down. They want to attack local government and order. That's what terrorists do. And there's a video on Infowars.com that needs to go mega viral. Drudge Report is linked to our story. China says Russia humiliated arrogant U.S. with simulated attack on warship. And I'm glad Drudge linked to that. But the story that's really important, and then I need the listeners to, we're going to put it on Facebook, Twitter, we need to get it out everywhere, is the videos that our crew got in Manhattan yesterday. And they're so hard working. They're already in Denver right now. They're going to be on in the fourth hour. And there's a whole bunch of these videos. And because the Bernie Hillary supporters cannot talk, all they do is scream threats and cuss words. We cannot play it here because it would just be beep, 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 beep. I mean, that's all it would be. There is a man up there at the Trump rally, not attacking people, but saying, defend yourself. There are sleeper cells. There is ISIS here. You need to protect yourself. And they start grabbing his sign, trying to rip it away, start grabbing his sunglasses, grabbing his hat. Then he pushes them back. And then they attack him and beat him up. And the police don't do anything. There are police on video with some of the Black Lives Matter people saying, I'm going to attack you. I'm going to physically assault you, and cussing at them. And the police do nothing. I mean, it's disorderly conduct to say, I'm going to physically attack you. And I guarantee you, I've been arrested in New York for protesting the firefighters and police not getting funding the first responders. I was literally protesting at Fox News over that. There's video of it. And the police came and arrested me and almost tore my shoulder out of socket. They put the handcuffs on so tight and so high on my back. And I did nothing. Nothing. Man, my white privilege really worked out there, didn't it? And am I going to just hate the cops because of that? No, they followed their evil orders. They followed what that big city machine wanted. Just like the Black Lives Matter are allowed to beat this guy up, and I'm not allowed to have a demonstration about the cover-up of the dust on 9/11 and media cover-up, because, see, I'm a good person. People are going to listen to me. What I'm saying will really help the country. So, see, I can't be allowed to be out there. But if I'm part of a group whose ideological leader is a cop killer that lives in Cuba, and if I go around singing chants about killing police, I would be allowed to tell the police that I'm going to physically attack them and menace them with my fist balled up in a fighting stance. No, there's a leftist George Soros privilege to destabilize this country. And the behavior of people like Black Lives Matter will then legitimize, and I don't think it actually does legitimize it, but it'll legitimize it in some people's minds when crazy, mentally ill cops shoot some innocent person, be they white, black, or whatever, in the back. And that goes on. Those cops need to get in trouble. But is a couple hundred people shot a year improperly by police? That's the number. 150, 200, it varies. Period. Is that the number one issue in this country? No. And you can look right at a Black Lives Matter person with all their hate and all their craziness. In fact, show for the TV viewers some of the footage of the guy, the articles on Infowars.com. It's Black Lives Matter threatens to attack police. I believe it's the headline. If it's not the headline, it should be. And the guy is just whacked out of his mind, so angry and so hateful, threatening everybody to beat him up for their free speech. And telling a black Trump supporters, how dare you be supporting him, and just basically in a Tasmanian devil rage all because he really believes that this is a bunch of racists that are out to get him. And the guy is so angry, he just keeps saying, in between cuss words, Donald Trump isn't going to help. He's not going to raise your taxes, screaming at this black woman or group of black women. And then if we can, I want to show the footage when they physically attack. Video, anti-Trump mob assaults Trump supporter, leftist rip sign, throw punches at man, steal his sunglasses. Infowars.com. And then there's also I mean, I love that these leftists cannot fight. I mean, I'll just tell you right now that, I mean, I'm not bragging, but I would literally have just absolutely devastated all those people in about 10 seconds. I mean, I guess they've never had somebody actually punch them upside the head full power. I mean, I just, watching these people attack, it's like wimp punches and pawing and just, I mean, it's just ridiculous. Black Lives Matter threatens violence against whites who vote Trump. Yeah, that's from a few weeks ago. The latest one's up on Infowars.com. You guys just had it up. Yeah, that's it. And it's again, we can't play because of all the cussing. But he tells the cops, I'm going to knock you out. I'm going to take you out. I'm going to jump you. And they just sit there and take it. And I've had the same New York police, I don't mean those cops, come up to me when I'm 100 yards away showing a protest against the Iraq war and threaten to arrest me with hatred. And I was polite to him, and the guy got off on it more. But see, he knows that the system is backing those leftist thugs, so they know to leave them alone. So I'll tell you, the police are shameful, and so are those thugs. I mean, you're all a bunch of cowards. I don't mean all the police, obviously. I'm talking about police that sit there and let people do that. I mean, I've never seen a cop that lets you push them like that guy just did. And in their face, and then he threatens to hit them. It's just wrong that I've been arrested in New York and over again been treated like crap when I'm exercising my First Amendment that a lot of people died for. And because I'm a good person, I'm not allowed to. But a bunch of crazy people are. And I say let them, but don't let them beat people up. And the cops were 10 feet away and let them do it because they're intimidated by it. They're intimidated by, what is it, 4 New York cops last year been shot in the head just randomly? I mean, if you're so scared of George Soros, these people, what's going to happen when you start a war with the veterans and the patriots? And the gloves come off there. If you're scared of these Black Lives Matter and communists and these other idiot groups. I'm digressing. I'm just sick of it. I personally am really tired of it. So here are these articles. Video, a violent anti-Trump mob assaults Trump supporters. Protesters hang Trump effigy, beat up Trump impersonator outside New York GOP convention. Trump chalking by college Republicans is a hate crime, black students claim. Chalking threatens our tax-exempt status. Oh, yeah, see, no one can have speech now at a school or a church because it's tax-exempt. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. And individuals at a church or at a college undoubtedly have their free speech. But this is an attempt to go after our free speech. Bill Nye, the science guy, got asked by Mr. Moreno of Climate Depot if he agreed with the UN and others that are calling for the arrest of people that deny global warming, man-made global warming. Now it's man-made climate change. And he said, no, we should look at it. This is the standard position. But look, he's a little non-threatening guy with a bow tie telling you that polar bears can't swim. In fact, let's play a clip of that just to dovetail with all the censorship every day that we see ongoing, the attempt to bully us into total submission. Science guy Bill Nye, let's discuss criminalizing climate deniers. And this is being pushed by the New York Attorney General and others. And then Barbara Boxer will play attacks Catholic priests for questioning global warming. So see, it's all about being bullied. And what did the New York governor say? He said, if you're pro-gun or pro-life, get out. And they later said, are you serious? He said, yeah, get out. They're bullies. They believe their time has come. They're gangsters. And then Donald Trump comes and says, we should not have open borders and pay for everything free. And if they're not vetting any of the Muslims coming in, stop it all till it's vetted. Absolutely. And they go, oh, that's so hateful. And people then get to feel hurt. It's like you own something now to be hurt. Like, I get to be hurt. Good. I get to be hurt. Meanwhile, Mexico gives you 6 months to a year hard labor if you're caught coming in from Latin America and tortures you to find out where more illegals are hiding. That's in the London Guardian, by the way. No one is tougher on borders in Latin America than Mexico. It's one of the worst countries for illegals in the world except for North Korea. I mean, they don't put up... Japan doesn't let one Muslim immigrate there. Japan has the lowest crime rate in that area of the world, probably the world after Switzerland, where it's hard to immigrate there, too. Japanese just leave their doors wide open. There's almost zero crime in Japan. Now, let's go ahead and go to Bill Nye. Time to talk about arresting people for their free speech. And he ties it to cigarettes and stuff like that. No, the cigarette companies knew and paid people to produce false science. We are saying it's the sun, and we're saying there's a carbon scam where you want, so you're the ones that are pushing a lie for money gain. You're the ones involved in racketeering, not us. Here it is.
We interviewed Robert F. Kennedy Jr., the environmentalist, here at the People's Climate March in 2014, mm-hmm. September. He said that the climate deniers, his word, and energy CEOs belong at The Hague with three square meals and a cot with all the other war criminals. What is your thought on that? Do you think some of the rhetoric on your side, as I'm sure both sides, but some of the rhetoric on your side gets too carried away? I mean, what's your thought on jailing skeptics as war criminals?
We'll see what happens. Was it appropriate to jail the guys from Enron?
Interesting.
Okay, right. So we'll see what happens. Was it appropriate to jail people from the cigarette industry who insisted that this addictive product was not addictive and so on? And you think about, in these cases, for me as a taxpayer and voter, the introduction of this extreme doubt, where you go with extreme doubt about climate change, is affecting my quality of life as a public citizen. So I can see where people are very concerned about this and are pursuing criminal investigations as well as engaging in discussions like this.
That is flaming tyranny. Now it's not just hate speech, it's extreme doubt. Oh, so we need to have criminal investigations of that. And I'm going to do a little promo piece with this where the record skips at a key point when he says Enron. Do you know who in 1990, with Al Gore at a summit, and Al Gore's written about this before Enron got exposed, do you know who developed carbon taxes and the global carbon trading scheme with N.M. Rothschild? This is mainstream news. Enron. It's an Enron scam. And then he uses their own scam organization as the reason we lose free speech. They fixed energy prices, and that wasn't enough to make $1 billion a day sometimes in California. Enron environmentalism, the carbon credit scam, pumps millions of tons more greenhouse gas into the atmosphere. Boom. Mainstream article. Let's play the Enron clip. Here it is.
Was it appropriate to jail the guys from Enron?
Interesting.
Okay, right. So we'll see what happens.
Man, you know, it's like I'll be watching CNN and they got a guy saying I'm dangerous and bad and don't listen to me. And I go, wait a minute. I remember reading about an analyst at the Pentagon running a bunch of stuff, a Buck Sexton. I think that guy's CIA. We look him up, he's CIA. They don't get on TV and say, hey, I'm CIA up here going after Alex Jones. But see, I remember who came up with the carbon scam, Bill Nye. Man, you're an enemy of freedom. What a tyrant. A new story up on DrudgeReport.com. It's also on Infowars.com. From Breitbart. Colorado caucus volunteers, ballot errors hurt Trump delegation and candidates, could have violated state rules. where you're only allowed to vote for Ted Cruz, even though you're already all vetted. Most of them had promised to go for Cruz. They wanted 100% victory. So they were so arrogant, they gave him every delegate. And then they went on TV and gaslighted us. That's a CIA term for just saying, you're not on planet Earth. You're not Alex Jones. You're not Matt Drudge. You're not, you know, whoever you are, John Brown. You're not who you, and you're like, yeah, I am. No, you're crazy. Then a room full of people tell you you're nuts. There's not voting for primaries. There never was, silly. Silly. We're going to be getting to that more. I want to get more into this whole climate change situation with Barbara Boxer, where it's all about shaming us now and nudging us and henpecking us and dominating us. And we may have to arrest you. Yeah, we're going to go shut down the Trump rallies, too. We're going to beat up people, and the cops aren't going to do anything, even though we, you know, run around these groups calling for attacking the police. Because it's what the establishment wants. Obviously, our crews are all over the place. We're working very hard. We're trying to fund coverage in Cleveland and Bilderberg coming up next month and so much more. We've got the best products at InfoWarsStore.com. The best nutraceuticals, the best pro-gun, anti-globalist apparel, so you can meet like-minded people and spread the word. We have an unprecedented 25% off the already discounted. So you have retail, then you have discounted. It's 25% off discounted. It's 45% off retail on BrainForce. And I'm telling you, folks, at $22, similar nootropics have fillers in them and are a bigger bottle, cost $60. We have less caplets in it. And it has a lower price, but if we did the fillers and stuff, it'd be a huge bottle and have more caplets in it, but we don't do fillers. And it'd be $60. $22. Okay, so it is 45% off its regular retail. And it's got the 30 caplets in it. And just try it out today, ladies and gentlemen. A lot of folks want to be able to get a bigger bottle at a higher price. We're coming out with one of those, a little bit of discount on that as well. But this is the best nootropic we could come up with, the best formula, period. We go out and find what is the most organic, what is the safest, what is the most hardcore. Read the 5.0 reviews, InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. InfoWarsLife.com. InfoWarsStore.com is where you find the non-GMO heirloom seeds, shortwave radios, Hillary for President shirts, and over 1,000 other amazing items, high-quality, storable food. DNA Force is back in stock. It's got 175 studies behind it, just one ingredient, the BioPQQ. Do yourself a favor. Go read about it today. Whether it's a bottle of colloidal silver, silver bullet, or DNA Force, whether something costs $9.95 or $130, it is the very best stuff out there, and we need to sell a lot of it to fund this operation. By the grace of God, we're still here because of your prayers. I will tell listeners, we've never had more success than now. Best of times, worst of time. I have never had more demonic enemy attacks of every form and every level, and I literally rely on God, and I pray for your prayers. I need your prayers, and I need providence. I'm committed. I'm going to do everything I've got to do. I'm not going to stop ever. I just need your support and your prayers, and I appreciate it. And so do our affiliates and everybody else who supports the InfoWar. And Lord knows I'm not perfect, but I'm doing the best I can before God. People say, man, why all the God stuff if you're not a Christian? Look, this is, I believe in God. It's how I cope, okay? There are no atheists in foxholes. And let me tell you, live my life. And then just, I couldn't do this if I didn't have God to lean on. And that's what it comes down to. I just get stronger as the attacks intensify, though, because God's a rock. And the closer I get to God, the stronger I get. We'll be back. Stay with us. InfoWarsLife.com. Support us today. We're back live, broadcasting worldwide. Larry Nichols is popping in with breaking news. Colonel Rob Manis, running for Senate in Louisiana, is popping in. Peter Schiff, Rob Dew, is going to be on the road with the rest of the crew, Joe Biggs and others, coming up in the fourth hour with David Knight. They were going to be on the third hour, but they're really sleepy. They just got in from New York. We're up till 2 in the morning last night, flew out at 7 a.m. this morning out of New York, and so they're in Denver taking a nap right now. The demonstration starts at, 3 o'clock Mountain Standard Time. 3 o'clock Mountain, so that's 4 o'clock here. So we're talking about 4 hours, and they're going to be covering that live feeds on the Skype. In fact, I suggest that, I should have told you guys this earlier, we probably just need to go ahead and boot things up. maybe just stream over our own systems there. Or they can use Ustream or whatever for their safety. But so many of the anti-Trump folks are attacking cameras, and they've also promised to dress up in InfoWars outfits to provocateurists. We have that from inside sources. So we'll know their names. We'll know what group they came from. God knows if the police will do anything, though, in this country. Because I guess if you're an American patriot and follow the law and are a good person, and you're against shooting police in the back of the head, you don't get any police support. At least in these places like Denver and New York. I've been attacked in Denver by the stupid anarchist people, communists. Everything with them is a lie. You know, they'll call themselves anarchists, and they got communist tattoos and red flags and hammers and sickles. Because their bosses tell them, there's no communism, we don't want the public to know we're communist, so call yourselves an anarchist. And they're always in black, and they always talk about killing babies, and how they love the devil, and how they love being ugly. Who do these people come from? Why is there so much garbage out there? I don't understand all these people that love evil. I know one thing, though. They take our restraint for weakness, and man, I tell you, you really are pushing it hard. That's all I'm going to tell you right now. You're really pushing it hard. All you evil people, you're going to get it. Just know that sooner or later, God's going to cut you down. But maybe we should come in with that Johnny Cash. You can run on for a long time. Run on for a long time. Sooner or later, going to cut you down. Sooner or later, God's going to cut you down. Yeah, plotting in the dark against your fellow man. What's done in the dark will be brought to the light. I already played Bill Nye the Science Guy saying, yeah, we should look at arresting people that don't believe in man-made global climate change, don't want to pay their good carbon taxes, because Enron was a scam. Well, Enron was engaged in energy trading fraud. What does that mean? Enron created the carbon tax scam with Al Gore and the Rothschilds on record. The irony of these people. The criminality of it. But let's play Barbara Boxer attacking a Catholic priest for questioning global warming. Let's play that clip.
This is one of the greatest moral crimes. If you make energy more expensive or you prohibit or restrict people from getting energy from sources like coal, that's literally death.
Mr. Epstein, are you a scientist?
No, philosopher.
You're a philosopher?
Yes.
Okay.
Bet money's a listener. That's true. That's what Lord Monckton says.
This is the Environment and Public Works Committee. I think it's interesting we have a philosopher here talking about an issue.
It's to teach you how to think more clearly.
Well, you don't have to teach me how to think more clearly.
Yeah, she's got an Enron scam.
Try running for the Senate on your platform. Reverend Nelson, perhaps the most, well, this is the place to have a philosopher, not a scientist. It's perfect for this Republican.
You have to integrate the big picture data.
I'm not asking you anything. I'm telling you that all you have to know is you're a philosopher, not a scientist, and I don't appreciate getting lectured by a philosopher about science. Now, I want to talk to... I can ask you what I want. Do you disagree with the Pope on climate change? It's a simple yes or no.
When the Pope says...
We'll be back. Stay with us. We live in a very epic time on this world right now. Everybody can see it. And Larry Nichols is somebody that saw it. Green Beret, Commando, all over the world fighting communists, recruited into the shadow government. Dixie Mafia, that's what it is in the South. Brought the Clintons into power, was there, saw me in Arkansas, the drug deal and the dead kids, and said, I'm not going to be part of it anymore, and went public against him. And he's the guy that helped bring forward the information that began the impeachment. And he's the fella that got ostracized, demonized, and attacked by these folks. And Larry Nichols is our guest here today, just for the next 20 minutes or so. He's got some breaking news and intel for us. Then we have a man running for Senate, Colonel Rob Manish, popping in, Peter Schiff, on what's happening with the economy. We've got Rob doing the rest of our crew from Denver. They'll be at the site of the demonstration. We'll see all InfoWarriors converge on that, on the west steps of the Colorado State Capitol building, 200 each, Colfax Avenue, Denver, Colorado. And they're going to be in Portland, where the left has said no one is allowed to be there for the student groups to speak. No Trump supporters are allowed. They attacked them last week. Six Trump supporters peacefully there. And so our crew is going as listed speakers to speak to their group, and we'll be there and witness what happens. Hope you come there and support the First Amendment. We expect the college to actually help them attack the crew. The crew is ready. They wanted to go to illustrate. They'll be like Gandhi. I mean, I've told them, let them hit you if you want or defend yourself, but they're going to let them hit them first. They're there, and I'm sure it'll be on the news that we're evil and bad. This is something Joe Biggs and Rob New and others want to be part of and defend the First Amendment. The good news is a lot of CBS News, U.S. News World Report, even Associated Press are going, you know, you really should count votes in primaries. This is not something that's been done before where you just ignore them. Now, stop it. This is a dictatorship. Quit. So the public didn't buy it. The mainstream media tried to sell it. It didn't work. So now they're backing off that a little bit. Doesn't mean they still won't try to steal it. But Sarah Palin said there should be an uprising, basically. I didn't say that, and accused myself and Stone of Roger Stone trying to call for a war. We're going to win in the info war, folks. We don't want it to go physical. Of course, if it does, we're going to win that, too. But our guest is Larry Nichols, and Larry is having trouble speaking today. He is battling cancer, and folks should pray for him. And he has his oxygen tubes out right now. He had a tracheotomy last time he was on with us. So he's a tough old bird, and we love him. And Larry, good to have you here with us, my friend.
Hey, man, how are you? How are you doing?
I'm doing good, my friend. How are you doing?
I'm here. Listen, Alex, I'm here today because I've got to make an announcement. They're not going to let him have the nomination. Donald Trump has a move that he can make. I've tried every way I know how. I know you have to get Trump in touch with me. It's not something I've made up. It's not something I've hypothesized.
Well, some of what we talk about does get to him. Some of what we talk about does get to him. I mean, I can tell you that.
I understand.
Go ahead.
I understand. What Donald Trump should do, and I mean he should do it this weekend, he should hold a press conference and he should say, I'm not doing it for me. I'm doing it on behalf of the American people. I'm bringing my cadre of attorneys in. I'm paying for them. And I'm filing theft by deception lawsuit against the RNC. Now, I know there'll be attorneys that say, oh, that's crazy. You can't sue the RNC. Well, I was told, if you'll remember, Alex, I couldn't sue the president either with Paula Jones. Well, by God, I did. And by God, we got him under oath and he lied and we got him for perjury. That's what got him impeached. And he needs to say very clearly that the attorneys I hire, we're filing the lawsuit. It should be filed under criminal court. But we know Obama and the criminal people, they're not going to do that. So he's going to have to file it civilly. And then Alex, within 3 weeks, he should make it known. Karl Rove, Rince Priebus, Paul Ryan, et al., whoever else, Mitt Romney, that within 3 weeks, he plans to have his attorneys have them under deposition, under discovery.
Well, Paul Manafort, who pretty much runs his campaign now and is coming on very soon, he went on, as you know, Meet the Press mm-hmm. a week ago and said that they are looking, quote, at filing complaints and lawsuits. And I actually believe it's going in that direction. Regardless, just to point out, we're saying this is fraud. We're saying people should be allowed to vote in America.
Right. Well, This is a technical point of law. I mean, number one, the RNC reached one bridge too far, Alex, when they went and had Louisiana, Colorado, and a couple of other states prematurely go ahead and take delegate votes from Trump. Had they have waited until 1 week, 6 days before the convention, yeah, there'd been nothing anybody could do, Alex. The executive committee, rules committee, could have had their meeting 6 days before the convention, fixed it to steal the
thing. I totally agree with you. The way the rules were written, they could try some hanky-panky up around the convention. But the fact that they did it prematurely or just canceled caucuses altogether is amazing.
Well, and remember, Alex, to the people, y'all listen to me. And Trump, listen to me, damn it. Listen to me. There are people that have stood in line hours to hear you speak. There have people that have gone through great difficulty to go out and vote for you. Now, these Republicans, executives, they have no intention of letting you have the nomination. I don't care if you go in Alex, I've already told you there was an executive meeting where they discussed if he gets 1237 down to 1200, they're giving it to Kasich so they minimize the blowback. Look, guys, this stuff's been going on a long time. It has. But you see, when Trump got in the race, Alex, what changed this whole dynamic from years, years past? Normally, you remember I told you this months and years ago, in primaries, who has the most money always wins. So what the Republicans have always done to trick the elections, they get about 10 candidates to run in the beginning. They run all those guys off. They use up all their money. And then the only one left is the establishment candidate that has all the money in the world. In this case, it was supposed to be Bush. But here comes Trump. Trump don't need their money. And all of those rules broke down. Now they're forced to go out in public and do it right in front of everybody's eyes. If he will do this, I assure him he will get the nomination for the RNC. They can't stop him because what'll happen, you know this, Alex, we get Karl Rove and the boys in the box under oath and start asking them some questions like, golly gee, did y'all get together and communicate with the Louisiana Executive Committee? Did y'all by chance talk to and conspire with the Colorado RNC? Find out, make them say under oath what they did or did not do. And if, and I'll say this to Rich Priebus and Karl Rove and all you pumpkin heads, listen to me. Everything Hillary Rodham Clinton has on every one of you, some of you will put you in jail. All of you, it'll make you awfully ashamed of your name. Everything she's got, I got. And I swear to you, I will use it. I'm going to use it. Now, the best thing everybody can do can zip this thing up. Trump can get his act together. I don't need him to bring in these pros from Dover, Alex. You know, he can bring in that guy you're talking about and all these other guys that can count delegates and all the other. I know when the fix is in. I know how it works. And I know what they're planning. They figured that even if they steal it from Trump, Hillary will get it. And then, you know what? They'll do what they've done before. Look, if you're a good Republican, do you want to vote for Hillary? Okay, yeah, you wanted Trump. But the guy we got's not Hillary. And that's how they think this is going to go. Put them under oath, Alex.
Well, I agree with you. It's a great plan. And I think something similar is being looked at. Why are the Republicans so arrogant, or is it desperateness, to openly cancel elections in different states and like Trump wins all these states and suddenly we hear he's lost and Hillary's doing it to Sanders? Sounds like the two parties have gotten together at the top. We know they have against the Tea Party and have decided to just steal it together and to cover each other's backs.
Alex, this is the last election we're going to have. Y'all, this is the last.
No, election. You were saying look that a year ago. You were saying that a year ago.
Yeah, look what's going on. You've got Biden and Obama and the head of the Federal Reserve meeting this week. Did you know it's a matter of national security? Those three are never to be in the same room away from the Capitol security. But they were. One of the things they talked about. This was in Reuters. This isn't me saying it, Alex. It was in Reuters. They were discussing martial law in case of a global meltdown. Then you've got the Monetary Fund, Global Monetary Fund people meeting in New York. They're coming in, China taking gold back in the...
Yeah, let's talk about the state of the world. Absolutely. They're not... Stay there, Larry. They're not doing desperate stuff, I agree, here and all over the world for no reason. They know stuff's coming so big, we won't even remember all the stuff they're doing now. I'm telling you, folks, my spidey sense is pegging. I mean, it's like the RPMs are just off the chart. I can feel it. I can see it. Woo! Man, I tell you, better get right with God, folks. Coming up after our guest leaves us, phone transcripts prove Hillary lied about Benghazi attack. Breaking. Infowars.com. Another exclusive article is up on DrudgeReport.com. Colorado caucus volunteers, ballot errors hurt Trump delegate candidates, could have violated state rules. Well, there, they just, even the few that wanted to vote who hadn't already been bought off were unable to because the ballots were just for the other guy. I mean, wow, they really are getting arrogant. You were getting into why you think this is all happening, Larry Nichols. And it is in the news that even mainline mega banks Royal Bank of Scotland, you name it, says sell everything you got. Economic implosion coming. Much of the world's already in a depression. Americans still aren't aware of it, but some days nothing's coming across the Atlantic or vice versa to the U.S. Shipping is coming to a halt, slowed down almost entirely from China. I mean, this is serious. What's the real state of the economy? Talking to your insiders, you said also there was more going on to Scalia than we knew. It came out, it was a secret society. Those two issues, Larry Nichols.
Well, number one, what's going on with the economy? If you'll notice, the FDIC has put out a warning about the five major banks. Folks, let me tell you, they use code words. Alex, there's a code word running around, floating around, called negative interest. Now, guys, I know some of you are thinking, and the public, a lot of the public's thinking negative interest. Oh, boy, that means our house payment will really go down. No. Negative interest means, are you listening to me? Negative interest means they're going to charge you interest to keep your money in the bank. They're not going to pay you interest.
And by the way, that's already started in four countries in Europe. It's already begun. It means taxes on money transfers.
Then they're going to nationalize and repatriate. That's what all this stuff is going on about the banks and the FDIC. One of my people inside with the FDIC is talking about there's a group, a core, that is fighting the repatriation and nationalization of the banks under this financial meltdown. And they're going to use, of course, we've got to stop the downfall of the country. Now, what nationalization and repatriation means, and Alex, I've been in three countries, four, I guess, that collapsed. Two of my help. In those countries, what nationalization means, the government's going to come in and take over the bank.
And they're going to make the mega banks' foreign debt our debt. It's not real nationalization. It's globalization.
It's globalization. But now the repatriation part of the nationalization is that means folks are claiming all the money's theirs. Your money. Your money belongs to them.
Bail-ins.
They're going to take your money. If you don't get your money out of the bank now, excuse my dog, but if you don't get your money out of your bank now, there's going to be a day very, very soon that you're going to go down there and get it, and they're going to say, what money are you talking about? What money? And you may think that you've got this bank that's local and it's not connected to this mega conglomerate. You're wrong. Your bank, right where you're at, is connected to these big global banks. It's all. They've done it. They've got it globalized. That's why Trump has to do what I'm saying. We've got to fight, or this country's done. And if you don't believe me, look at what they're doing, Alex. They don't care that you know they're rigging the election. They don't care that the American people are figuring out, wait a minute, I thought I went to vote for a candidate for president. And now I find out what Nichols and Alex Jones and all these people have been saying for years, my vote don't mean nothing. They're going to pick who they want. There's a reason they're doing it. It's because they know in the next few weeks, if we have that long, this thing's coming down.
Well, now Larry, you're going out on a limb here, and you're a credible guy, and I respect you, but you're saying the next few weeks. This is inevitable the next few years. You're saying the hammer fall is coming.
It ain't going to take years, and we're lucky. It might take months, but I doubt it. Look, Obama's sitting there. He's making his plans. You got Obama with his Islamic creeps wanting to take over our country.
Larry, I'm going to have you back up sometime this week for a full hour. Stay there. I'm going to put your P.O. box up for folks that want to contact you or support you. NicholsLive@AOL.com on PayPal. Folks, he's battling lung cancer. NicholsLive@AOL.com. Folks, you need to support this patriot. Larry Nichols, 58 Kingston Drive, Conway, Arkansas, 72034. God bless you, Larry. We'll talk to you soon. Wow. About a year ago, with Hillary saying fun camps for men, and we've actually got army manuals now that are talking about re-education camps in America for political dissidents. This is what Obama's actually putting out. And now we have Bill Nye, the science guy, coming out and going, no, we need to look at arresting climate change deniers. And then he goes on, because look at Enron. Well, Enron is what came up with a scam with Al Gore. I'm going to play that clip and then go to our guest. But everywhere, these anti-Trump people are out there trying to beat people up. Our own crew in New York caught it three times on tape yesterday. They're in Denver today. They're going to be on the fourth hour. on the ground live with the demonstrations about to begin at the RNC, where they just didn't have the caucuses and just gave it to Ted Cruz. And look, I've never been an enemy of Ted Cruz. I just don't like seeing things like that happen. And Hillary's taking them from Sanders in Louisiana. Trump won, but then Cruz got more delegates and now is the winner of the state. And Sarah Palin came out in U.S. News and World Report and said, voters should decide GOP nominee. That's surreal. Of course they should. Here's another one from CBS News saying the same thing. Why the GOP can't take the nomination from Donald Trump. Regardless, this is an attack on free speech is why I'm covering this. Let's play Bill Nye the Science Guy. Mark Moreno is on Earth Day next week, the fellow that did this interview. It's just a minute long where he says, yeah, we should look at going after these people. The attorney generals in multiple states are talking about indicting climate change deniers. I mean, this is the attack on free speech, folks. One step from the Red Dawn scenario, isn't it? With Hillary up there on the jumbo screen. We're going to the Senate candidate has a good chance of winning in Louisiana, speaking of stolen elections. And we're going to be talking to him here in just a second. But first, here's Bill Nye, the Science Guy.
We interviewed Robert F. Kennedy Jr., the environmentalist, here at the People's Climate March in 2014, mm-hmm. September. He said that the climate deniers, his word, and energy CEOs belong at The Hague with three square meals and a cot with all the other war criminals. What is your thought on that? Do you think some of the rhetoric on your side, as I'm sure both sides, but some of the rhetoric on your side gets too carried away? I mean, what's your thought on jailing skeptics as war criminals?
We'll see what happens. Was it appropriate to jail the guys from Enron?
Interesting.
Okay, right. So we'll see what happens. Was it appropriate to jail people from the cigarette industry who insisted that this addictive product was not addictive and so on? And you think about, in these cases, for me as a taxpayer and voter, the introduction of this extreme doubt, where you go with extreme doubt about climate change, is affecting my quality of life as a public citizen. So I can see where people are very concerned about this and are pursuing criminal investigations as well as engaging in discussions like this.
Enron, just type in Enron carbon tax, Enron global warming. I mean, they're the ones that wrote the treaties, everything, with Al Gore and others. They were going to make the money. They got in trouble for fake energy trading. That's the scam. The cigarette people knew it was causing cancer and paid for fake science and admitted it. That's called fraud. It's not fraud to say, hey, the sun drives climate. And then they get the emails from these people, remember, at the major university, coordinating over 1,000 universities to, quote, hide the decline in global temperature records. That's all I'm saying. All right, going to our guest for the balance of the hour, Colonel Rob Manish, has an amazing background. Traveled from the Air Force 4 years ago for serving his country, 32 years, including in combat. He commanded a B-1 bomber squadron. Well, those are neat planes. In Iraq and Afghanistan's wars, commanded the sixth largest Air Force base in the world and served as an advisor to the Joint Chiefs of Staff following the 9/11 attacks. He helped author the plan for International War on Terror, Colonel Manish. Just so much other stuff he's done. It'll take too long to go over it. But Colonel Manish is also responsible for authoring 3 pages in the Nuclear Black Book. Travels ever with the president. His military awards and combat decorations include the Legion of Merit, the Bronze Star, and the Air Medal. And it goes on. Rob completed his undergraduate work while attending night school at University of Tampa and holds 3 master's degrees from Harvard University's Kennedy School and the Air Command and Staff College and the U.S. College of Naval Warfare, robmanis.com. But it's spelled Manis. So it's Rob, M-A-N-E-S-S.com, Rob, ESS.com. Colonel Rob Manish joins us now via Skype. Thanks for coming on.
Oh, thanks for having me on, Alex. And my mother thanks you for reading that bio. We really appreciate it.
Well, it's a great bio. Man, those are neat planes. They still haven't retired those yet, have they, with the whole swept wings and everything?
No, they haven't retired them. As a matter of fact, we had just brought them home and replaced them with B-52s in the air attacks on the Islamic State over in the Middle East. So the B-1s could get some much-needed upgrades. They had been carrying the workload for the airstrikes against ISIS since the beginning of the bombing operations against them.
I ought to interview sometime just about those. I mean, I've seen them fly over in Austin on 4th of July. It looks like a spaceship, even though it was made in the 80s.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and it's very fast. There's nothing like going supersonic speeds in an aircraft that's the same weight class as a DC-10.
And those fly super low. I mean, you can fly really low with those, right?
Absolutely. The automatic terrain following system can take you down to 250 feet at approaching supersonic speeds.
So, do they all have the escape pod and stuff?
No, their air crews are in ejection seats in the B-1 bomber.
Didn't it previously have like an escape pod or something?
The original design did have an escape pod in it. Yes, it did.
Now, talk about, I'm sorry, let's get into the campaign and why we need you in the U.S. Senate.
Well, you kind of hit on it in the intro and the videos, especially with this Nye fellow. Look, Alex, I'm just a normal red-blooded American that cares about his country and is just tired of seeing the republic torn down. And we take an oath to the Constitution of the United States. And I'm disappointed in men like General Wesley Clark who say that folks that care about the Constitution aren't loyal to the United States. He's lost track of what we are about. What we are about in this country is about the natural rights that every human being has and the limited government that the Constitution is supposed to construct for us that gives everybody the ability to hold themselves and their children accountable, to be fiscally responsible, and ensures equality of opportunity for all of us, regardless of how we were born or where we came from. And Mr. Clark, unfortunately, seems to think that we owe allegiance to the government of the United States. Well, that's just not true. We owe it to the Constitution of the United States. And the government that's currently in place in the United States of America has completely outgrown the Constitution of the United States. And I'm running for the United States Senate because I believe in those four things that I just told you. And we've got to get our country back into a constitutional form of government.
Tell us about the policies, what you would do if you get in the U.S. Senate. And obviously, I'm supporting you over the people you're running against. I mean, how do we help get you in there? Because I know that we've got a good shot at it.
Well, first of all, it's foreign policy. You know, look, I have 32 years in the Air Force. I graduated from the Harvard University Kennedy School of Government. I studied international security and foreign policy there along with domestic politics. I'm a graduate of the U.S. Navy War College in National Strategy. And I believe in the Constitution. I'm a constitutionalist. I believe in pro-America foreign policy, not pro-UN foreign policy. That's just absolutely crazy. We've got to protect America's citizens and vital national interests before we do anything else. We've got to do things like insist that Congress executes its appropriate role in foreign policy and declaring war and those kind of things. And I don't believe in going into every little dictatorship and toppling those guys and creating chaos around the world. We've done that way too much. And we don't want to sacrifice our children's lives unnecessarily, the ones that volunteer to defend this country. And I have three sons in the United States military. My youngest one that's in is an airman, and he's on his way back today to the United Kingdom, where we just rolled up some more terrorists, including one at the airport just down the road from where he'll be landing tonight or in the morning. So we've got a lot at stake here in this country with our kids putting their lives on the line for us, just like I did for 32 years and my dad did. So we've got to make sure that we're not out there toppling dictators and getting involved unnecessarily in these countries and protecting America's interests.
Sure. What do you think, Colonel?
America's interests.
What do you think? Again, Senate candidate Colonel Rob Manus joining us, robmanus.com. What do you think Obama's thinking when they bring in hundreds of thousands, it's hundreds of thousands, millions into Europe, most 80% are military-age men, they're already doing sleeper attacks, a lot of experts believe they're planning a jihad Tet offensive in Europe. What's going to happen when thousands, conservatively, and that's what most experts agree, at least 10,000, just operate and start killing everybody and blowing stuff up and attacking nuclear plants, they're already having guards getting killed, disappearing. What's going to happen to the government when this happens and they brought them in? Are they so dumb that they think they won't get in trouble? I mean, I'm just wondering, why would the socialists like Merkel and Hollande and Obama want to be doing this? I mean, why do they ally themselves with radical jihadis? We know they were backing them before in Syria, but the military said no to it and the people said no. So now they've been forced to counter Islamic State. I mean, what's going on where the Russians start to look more like the good guys? And I'm not defending what the Russians do. They have a lot of problems. Yeah. But that's how bad Obama is, in my view.
Well, we've got to remember that his goal is to transform the United States of America. And I truly believe that he believes in his heart of hearts that American foreign policy and the foreign policy of Western Europe is the evil, has contributed and caused all of the evils of the world, which is absolutely not true. Look, we're weaker than we've ever been. We no longer lead, and the world's on fire. We need to stay strong, and we need to lead in the world. But that doesn't mean that we need to go putting our kid and military forces into all these countries and intervening where it's not appropriate because our interests aren't at stake. We've got to make sure we're defending America's interests first. Look, you know, your question reminds me of the border situation in our own country. And you kind of touched on
the Border Patrol admits security. That they, quote, complete the smuggling process. Our own reporters 2 years ago, Jakari Jackson, Don Salazar, went down the border. Colonel, and the Border Patrol admitted we're ordered to bring the illegals in and give them vouchers and complete the smuggling process. I mean, just backing you up. How do they search me when I fly in, you know, from Europe, search my bags, but then illegals just walk in?
My son flew home on leave from the United Kingdom a month ago on the same day that the Brussels attacks occurred, and he was on an American Airlines flight. And before he even got through security, he had to answer 32 specific questions just to board the flight to the United States of America. So we've got a problem. And part of the problem is that we have folks that are in office right now leading this country, and it doesn't really matter what letters behind their name. You know that, Alex, and that's why, our presidential candidates on the GOP side are so popular, the two frontrunners are, is because they believe in Americanism. We believe in Americanism, our sovereignty. It's simple. We must respect our own laws. That's all we ask for, is that other people respect our laws. And we've got to do two things when it comes to things like internal security and immigration control. We've got to do two things. It's all we've got to do to get things on the right track, and that is secure our border, secure our darn border, and get ourselves to make ourselves enforce our current law. Our current law is not being enforced, and if we enforce current law, just on the Mexican side and the Central American side alone, the illegals that are in this country, there's Pew polling out there, that data out there that shows that even, and it was taken during the Obama administration, that even during his administration, upwards of 1.2 million people would go back to their homes in Central, South America, and Mexico a year if we would just enforce our current law. I mean, my goodness, what's wrong with respecting American law? It is the law of the land, this thing we call the Constitution of the United States.
What do you think the president is thinking, Colonel, when the border's basically wide open and then there will be more terror attacks? They ordered the FBI, as you know, to say San Bernardino wasn't, but 2 days later it came out it was, and the FBI leaked that they were ordered to say it wasn't. There's got to be a major disconnect there. I mean, why would the president want to let us be attacked?
There's no disconnect, and I don't believe that it's that he wants to let us be attacked, per se. Is that he doesn't believe that we're going to be attacked. In spite of all of the series of attacks under this man's watch, of terrorist attacks from Islamic jihadist extremists, from Boston to Chattanooga to Fort Hood to San Bernardino, all of those attacks, and the man just still looks the camera in the eye and the American people in the eye and says, I don't believe that we're under attack. These are all lone wolves. And that's the spin that he's trying to put on it. And quite frankly, he has the mainstream media on his side, and he knows that he can keep the American people asleep in large
numbers. And he was successful. Colonel, as you know, when it came to the shootings at the Army, Navy, Marine Corps centers, they would just cover those up. Or the cops getting shot with the people yelling Allah Akbar. They say it's not terror-related. You never hear about it again. Or the nightclub getting attacked in Canada. It's happening all the time.
It happens all the time. And while the fatality numbers are low, and he likes to use the numbers of more people are killed in such and such a deal or have been killed in such and such deals, whatever it is, you pick the vehicle that he uses, as opposed to those killed by terrorism since 9/11. But that's not the point. The point is, this is the United States of America. Men and women like me have risked their lives and given their lives and their bodies to protect the United States of America and the American people. And I've served for 32 and a half years doing that, supporting the Constitution. And now I have to live with the fact that my 11-year-old and my wife don't feel secure in their own homes. but because of these Islamic jihadist terrorisms, because men like Barack Obama insist on not even calling the enemy what it is. Well, we know things in the military. We learn how to conduct wars and plan for wars, and you've got to do some simple things. It's not complicated. You first have to identify the enemy, and it's Islamic jihadism and extremism. That's what it is. Then you have to find the enemy, and we know where most of them are throughout the Middle East and North and Middle Africa now. And a lot of them are in Europe, as you just pointed out, Alex, and we know that. So let's start rolling them up. Let's find them. And then the next two steps are the hardest ones, because we got to have political will and courage to do that. And that is, you target them and you kill them all as rapidly as possible. That's the only thing that removes a threat, a growing threat like this does to the United States.
Well, absolutely. I want to know why the New York Daily News reports, CBS reports, they have planes all the time at JFK coming in from overseas, and they don't even check their passports or IDs because, quote, the, you know, the government tells them, let them in. And so I'm going to get searched. The TSA's there. It's all theater. My rights are being violated. It'd be one thing if they were actually stopping these people and then searching me, but no, they're searching me and my family, but then letting the obvious groups in. I mean, what's the equation there? I guess just train me how to train the public how to be a slave. Then there's more terror attacks and they take more of my rights, Colonel?
It's political correctness. Political correctness is going to be the end of this country and the end of freedom for the mankind if we don't get our arms wrapped around it. That's why we have folks doing so well that insist on not using political correctness. Look, we've got to call the enemy what it is, identify what needs to be done, and then get the job done. And we've got to stop doing stupid stuff like in Louisiana here, activists are fighting the real ID for the fifth year in a row so that the federal government doesn't get to have an entire database on all of the citizens of Louisiana except for the criminals, because they won't go participate in that. It's the same thing with gun control. You know, I'm a huge Second Amendment advocate. My family military service goes all the way back to the American Revolution, and the right to keep and bear arms is the foundation and the insurance policy for the freedom of all Americans and the insurance policy to protect the Constitution of the United States. And we will do that, just as your intro video showed. When pushed, we will get that job done. And you know what? The President of the United States needs to repeal the order that keeps commanders from arming their men and women on military bases today. Every man and woman that's in a uniform on duty should be armed with at least a sidearm today, whether you're in the United States or overseas. My son is stationed at a military base in Europe that just had a jihadi convicted of attempting to drive through the fence and grab the first military person that they could see and cut their throat while on video. And that's the kind of thing that's happening to our American men and women, and it's being planned against these soft targets.
And they wouldn't even say Major Hassan for 4 years was a jihadi. Remember that?
Oh, absolutely. It's the most ridiculous thing that I've ever seen. I was still in the military then. I couldn't really speak up and say anything. But I'm going to tell you now, that was the dumbest move this president has ever made, and he needs to be leaving office very quietly with his head hanging in shame for what he's done to the survivors and the wounded from the Fort Hood massacre.
Well, Colonel,
an Islamic jihadist.
Colonel Rob Manus, we only got about a minute or two left. People need to go to robmanus.com. They need to support your campaign. I know you're doing well, and I just hope you get into the U.S. Senate separately. I know you've got a lot of great ideas on cutting taxes and a lot of other things that folks can find out about there on the site. You find out how to volunteer. You got a store with some of the apparel and stuff for folks who want to help spread the word. But I tell you, I just want to restore sovereignty. I just want to restore this nation's basic integrity. We are having an attempt of a leftist takeover in this country, and I'm a libertarian. I'm not even so-called conservative. I'm just a patriot. And these people really think it's their time. They've uncloaked. They're showing themselves to really be aggressive. And we need a total landslide against these people. And we need establishment Republicans removed from office as well.
Absolutely, Alex. I appreciate you having me on. You can find us at Rob Manus on Twitter also. Thanks for showing the website at robmanus.com. And you know what? We've got to stop doing these dumb things in our government, like the 9/11 report, the 28 pages. Let's get that public. We've got to know who the enemy is. We've got to do that. We've got to do things like audit the Fed and those kind of things.
Well, that's awesome. You've got a lot of great policies. That's why we're supporting you. Colonel, God bless. Look forward to speaking to you when you're in the U.S. Senator before then.
God bless you, Alex. Thanks a lot.
You bet. What a great guy. We need people like that in the U.S. Senate and all these lawyers and all these establishment people, I tell you, who have set up a world government, basically, and they want to just fold us into it now and kind of graduate to that higher level of control. And it's time that that stop. I want nationalists, and I want them now. And I don't want them to bring the jihadis in and let them attack us to turn us into a police state. I mean, you want to grab my testicles after I even go through the scanner or whatever? I'm dying. The border is basically open. Leave me alone. And I'm not mad at the TSA themselves. It's the Congress. It's the government. I realize blaming the TSA, we need to blame the law and the feds. It's a joke. Okay, briefly, folks, we need your support now more than ever with our crew out there on the street 24-7, basically, and our reporters and Bilderberg coming up and everything else. Buy the Hillary for Prison t-shirts. Buy the Molon Lobby shirts. We have them in women's designs with gold lettering. They're just amazing. Looks like real gold. It's like gold foil. We have just so many other great products from shortwave radios and non-GMO seeds. And we have 45% off Brain Force, the ultimate brain-boosting, healthy nootropic out there. I mean, comparable stuff's like $60 a bottle. That's because they mark it up 5 to 6 times. I don't do that. Maybe I should. They don't have to plug all the time. But it's 25% off the already discounted price, 45% off normal retail for a limited time. InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella site. InfoWarsLife.com is the sub-site. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or call toll-free. We can answer all your questions, 888-253-3139. 888-253-3139. Vitamin Mineral Fusion is sold out. A lot of other stuff is selling out. So it's really hard to source these materials, especially on the multi-formulas. DNA Force, after 3 months being sold out, is back. It's the most amazing, true nutraceutical that we have with the best form of BioPQQ, CoQ10, and so many other items. DNA Force is back, and your purchase supports the broadcast. What a bottle of DNA Force will do for you is simply amazing. 175 studies linked to that particular product because it's so amazing and so documented. Several of the compounds in it are prescription in Europe, Japan, and other areas. We basically get this from the Japanese pharmaceutical industry, the division of Mitsubishi America, just one of the ingredients. That's how good it is. Not synthetic, but biological. DNA Force is amazing. Check it out. The nerve growth factor, what it does to your mitochondria. Look it up. I'm on it. And I'm not a beach boy or anything. I look better than I did, don't I? InfoWarsLife.com. Your purchase makes it all possible. I want to salute you and thank you for your support. We'll be back in the third hour, jam-packed with other guests and tons of news. This is Breaking Benghazi News. I hope that we can survive the mad scientists. Hell, asteroids and superquakes and things like that are a big enough issue to deal with. I'm going to talk about that some later. California is just due for megaquakes. It's like 2 years overdue. The entire rest of the Pacific Rim has had a big quake in the last decade. And when it hits, they think it's going to be super devastating. I'm not trying to be negative here. I'm just talking about how we just don't expect things till they hit us. We have a 7.4 earthquake hits southern Japan. We've got volcanoes going crazy all over the place. The inner areas of the Earth are definitely active. And imagine if they came out and said, if you don't believe that man is causing the earthquakes or man's causing the molten lava to be more active, we're going to put you in jail like Bill Nye says we should do we should look at doing if you don't believe in man-made global warming or now climate change or whatever else they tell you the science is fixed on when it's not. I mean, most scientists, astrophysicists and solar experts and others, they're like, no, it's the sun. But the UN had a vote 5 years ago and they said the sun has no effect on climate. It's like saying your water heater has no effect on the hot water that you have in your bathtub. I mean, it's the reason the water's hot. It's ridiculous. And they knew the sun started cooling down, the earth started getting cooler. The sun is in a more dormant phase. And they know that. And he goes, but Enron ran scams. They went to jail. Enron lied to people about how much the power was costing. And then Enron was the one that came up with the carbon tax. I just cannot believe the rich irony, the rich hypocrisy. It's not even hypocrisy. What is the word? Does Bill Nye not know that Enron came up with the whole scam? Or that the whole thing's about that? They've invested so much, they will not stop. And I never finished this clip. I want to finish it now. This is Barbara Boxer attacking first a philosopher. She says, I don't listen to philosophers. And then she goes and attacks Catholic priests because he doesn't agree with the Pope, who isn't a scientist either. But we can all look at the evidence and know that a carbon tax is a death sentence. That's what they're saying. Here it is.
This is one of the greatest moral crimes. If you make energy more expensive or you prohibit or restrict people from getting energy from sources like coal, that's literally death.
Mr. Epstein, are you a scientist?
No, philosopher.
You're a philosopher?
Yes.
Okay. Well, this is the Environment and Public Works Committee. I think it's interesting we have a philosopher here talking about an issue.
It's to teach you how to think more clearly.
Well, you don't have to teach me how to think more clearly. You don't have to try running for the Senate on your platform. Reverend Nelson, perhaps the most... Well, this is the place to have a philosopher, not a scientist. It's perfect for this Republican...
You have to integrate the big picture data.
I'm not asking you anything. I'm telling you that all you have to know is you're a philosopher, not a scientist, and I don't appreciate getting lectured by a philosopher about science. Now, I want to talk to... I can ask you what I want. Do you disagree with the Pope on climate change? It's a simple yes or no.
When the Pope says things that have to do with science, he does not speak from the Magisterium.
We'll be back. Stay with us. He was on the air, I don't know, 3 weeks ago with Mr. Dent, Peter Schiff, and I wanted to have a nice discussion. It got a little bit heated, especially on Dent's side. I didn't know that guy could get excited. But it was definitely very thought-provoking because I wanted to get Peter Schiff on with him because I think both guys are really smart, and I wanted to see where they think things are going. Peter has been saying that he thinks the IMF would basically and World Bank would call for a further race of negative interest rates. For folks that don't know what that means, we're going to break it down. We don't get lower interest rates. No. It means the banks start charging us basically to keep money. That's already started in a few areas of Europe. And if you want to know where we're going, look at Europe because... the bail-ins, just all the craziness. And they are gearing up here. They're admitting the economy's in trouble. The Federal Reserve admits it's in trouble. When Schiff predicted they would just, go up a small amount, he said then they might even go back after that. They're now talking about it. So we're going to find out what he thinks is going on. He's one of the best people to talk to because you're never sure. The establishment isn't kind of sure. They're kind of waiting to the last minute as well. We've seen the main New York Fed say they're out of bullets. Term Schiff used a couple years ago. They just don't have anything to do. And so many people go, well, I'm not in the stock market. I don't care. Everything's connected to this, folks. So we're on top of this giant bubble. And they're saying Trump is gloom and doom because he goes, we're in trouble. We're in a big bubble. And they go, oh, look at Trump, that fearmonger. I mean, we're on the biggest bubble ever. So Europac.com, billions under management. I'm not going to go into Peter Schiff's whole background. Most folks know who he is, best-selling researcher and author and radio host in his own right. Europac.com. I'm Alex Jones, of course, with Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. He'll be gone at the bottom of the hour, and then I'm going to spend 30 minutes on news. There's a bunch of it. Military news, Russians buzzing ships, our stories on DrudgeReport.com. There's just a lot of it. I'm going to get to it. In the fourth hour, our crew are in Denver, where people are protesting the RNC just canceling the election there. They tried to act like this was normal in like a con game, and now everybody's waking up to it, and even a lot of mainline Republicans are saying it's wrong. So we're going to get into that as well. Peter Schiff has a two-second delay, so I'm going to try to not jump in too much. The Skype's acting weird today, so we're going to go to Peter Schiff right now. Again, if you're a radio listener, Infowars.com/show, you can always add another dimension. Most of you listen at lunch or in your car. I get that, but when you're at home or want to add another level to it, Infowars.com/show. We are also going out on TV satellites, have some TV and cable systems like in Houston picking us up. We're about to roll that a lot bigger in the next few months and start listing a bunch of affiliates. Really exciting things on that front as well. But again, going to Peter Schiff, Schiff of Europac.com. Peter, thanks for coming on with us.
Oh, thanks for having me back on, Alex.
Where do we start? I mean, are we 30 seconds from midnight? I mean, how bad is it? What's really going on in the economy?
Well, it's no way to know exactly, the timetable, but obviously this economy is already back in recession. And if it's not in a recession, it's certainly on the cusp of one. But, if you look at the data that came out, we got industrial production numbers that came out earlier this morning. They were looking for a bounce. Instead, we got another decline. They revised the February number down. We got big inventories build again this week. Retail sales disappointed. I think it's clear that, you know, we could be in a negative GDP quarter right now. And, you know, I think that if the first quarter is bad, this second quarter is going to be worse, because the last couple of years we had a rebound in the second quarter because we had very cold winters. Well, this winter was the warmest in 120 years. So there is nothing to rebound from. If anything, some of the activity might have been pulled into the first quarter from the second. Meanwhile, you've got this huge inventory glut that needs to be wound down, and the trade deficit is getting worse. So there's a lot bearing down on U.S. economic growth. The problem for the Fed is, how do they launch a new round of stimulus and still pretend the economy is in good shape? Because that's the message President Obama is trying to sell, and that's the message that Hillary Clinton is trying to run on, and Janet Yellen doesn't want to take the wind out of their sails.
What does it signify? Was my analysis accurate, or what can you add of what negative interest rates will do, and then what do you predict they're going to do?
Well, I mean, negative interest rates are a disaster. I mean, it's not working in Japan. It's not working in Europe. It's not going to work here. But just because it doesn't work doesn't mean we're not going to do it, because everything we do doesn't work, and we do it anyway. But I think it shows desperation that you've had all these central bankers lowering interest rates and lowering interest rates and expecting it to revive the economy. And then when they get down to zero, rather than admit that it didn't work, because clearly if you go to zero and you still haven't achieved your objective, maybe it doesn't work. Instead of admitting that they were wrong, they're now going negative, which is just sheer desperation. But I do believe as inflation really starts to turn around in Europe and Japan, the central banks there are going to be forced to abandon 0% rates, and they're actually going to have to raise rates pretty high to get out in front of that inflation curve. But the United States, I don't think we're going to do anything. No matter how high inflation gets, we'll do our best to pretend it doesn't exist or rationalize it away, because we have a lot more debt. I mean, America is broke. If you look at Europe and Japan, even though there is some debt there, overall, those are still creditor nations. The world still owes Europe money. The world owes Japan money. But America owes more money than all the other debtor nations combined. I mean, Trump is right about that. I mean, we are broke. We're flat broke, and we're living off this credit bubble, and we can't prick it. So other central banks may be able to raise their rates, but the Fed can't.
How do you see this unfolding? I mean, what are the next triggers? We hear about sovereign debt. We hear about corporate debt. We hear about state debt. I mean, what could trigger the next big implosion? A huge earthquake in California? I mean, I guess another subprime mortgage crisis they're talking about is coming soon. I mean, there's so many irons in the fire that I see as being able to be a trigger. Or does it just keep sliding slowly? Because even mainline media now won't push the lie that they were just a year ago, that really the economy is doing fantastic. The only person doing that is Obama, who says we have the best economy ever, ever.
Yeah. Meanwhile, you know, we got some consumer sentiment numbers come out today, much worse than expected. Small business sentiment came out the lowest in 2 years. That was earlier this week. And in fact, small business owners listed the weak U.S. economy as their main concern. I mean, so if businesses are so concerned about the economy, how can it be so great? If you've got Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders doing so well, Sanders is now almost neck and neck with Clinton in the national polls. He's only down by like 1 or 2 points. And I think Trump came out today. This is his biggest lead yet in the national polls. I mean, why is that? These are the two candidates that are the ones that are most running as anti-establishment. The economy is a wreck, and I can do something to fix it. If the economy was so good, these candidates wouldn't be attracting so much support. So, you know, you're right, the economy is bad. It's just a question of people admitting it. And I think the trigger that's going to really send this into a higher gear is going to be the admission by the Fed that the economy is weak, or the markets figuring it out on their own. And then you really get a decline in the dollar, because now people start to realize that we're not going to get all these rate hikes that everybody's been betting on. We're going to get cuts. And the Fed doesn't have much room to cut, because it only managed to raise rates to a quarter. So there's not a lot of stimulus left. All they've got is potentially negative rates and a huge round of quantitative easing. And this thing is going to blow up in the Fed's face.
Sure. I mean, if the Fed's wrong about interest rates being at zero, being good, why is the IMF and World Bank, why are they cheerleading around? I guess IMF's more European, World Bank's more U.S., but I mean, the two are connected at the hip. But both those groups are basically saying the same thing.
Yeah, well, they're not any smarter. In fact, the IMF is still projecting the U.S. economy to grow at about 2.2% this year, which, you know, there's no chance of that happening, because if you look at how bad the first quarter is, the rest of the year is going to have to be above 3%. And I don't know why the IMF would actually believe that. It's more of this propaganda. The IMF, they're a bunch of bureaucrats. They want to believe that the U.S. economy is going to be strong because that's the Federal Reserve. That's the central bank's program. I mean, the government is trying to create economic growth, and the IMF wants to pretend that they're successful. They don't want to acknowledge all this government failure. The only way to get real government economic growth is to get the government out of the way. Institutions like the IMF just interfere with economic growth.
I agree. We're about to go to break, and I want to come back and ask you just front and center, because you're the expert, other key things about the economy you want to impart to folks. Peter Schiff's our guest. But separately, I'm not happy the economy's falling apart. I'm not happy we're on a bubble. I'm not doom and gloom. I just want to be honest with people. Our audience has been roughly doubling every year for the last 5 or 6 years. It's growing even faster. More affiliates, more people watching videos, more people watching podcasts. Until, I mean, this didn't even happen in 2008. But until about 2 or 3 years ago, as audience went up, our money went up. The amount of money coming in went up so I could expand with reporters and writers and everything else. Audience gets bigger, more money comes in. For the first time ever the last few years, our audience is exploding, but money is not going up, Peter. And I've gotten better at sponsors and raising money. So despite every trick I've got, it's harder than ever. Most media, as you know, is downsizing or going out of business. So I'm seeing it, even in a, quote, boom town where we're based, like Austin, Texas, I'm seeing it across the country.
Yeah, well, absolutely. I mean, people have less money. People have less money to spend. And so advertisers are cutting back and everybody's feeling it.
So I mean, you think that we may already actually be in a recession.
Yeah, well, all of the indicators, if you look at most of the economic indicators that are out there, they're flashing recession. I mean, the only thing that isn't is the low unemployment rate and the jobs that we're creating. But then when you look beneath the surface, and we've discussed this before on your program, when you realize that all the jobs that are being created are low-paying part-time jobs, the reason there are so many jobs is because people now have two or three. And so if you have three jobs, that, you know, you count as having, you know, it's three instead of just one. But they don't add up to one good full-time job. And you have lots of people who have left the labor force. And I think one of the reasons the unemployment claims are so low is because so few people are being hired that not that many people are being fired. You can't lose a job unless you get a job. And so since we're really creating so few legitimate jobs, there's not a lot of people that are collecting unemployment. So this economy is very weak, despite the rosy scenario, the fiction that the president is trying to paint. But Wall Street still doesn't get it. You know, if you look at performance, investment performance in the first quarter, this was the worst quarter for actively managed accounts in 18 years.
Peter, stay there. Let's talk about the real state of the economy, the next shoe to drop, and more straight ahead. Peter Schiff, Europac.com. I'm Alex Jones with Infowars.com. Stay with us.
My fellow InfoWarriors, my fellow Americans, there's never been an attack on our voting rights and our free speech in this country's history like we're seeing right now. Last weekend, they canceled the election in Colorado for the Republican primary and awarded all the delegates to Ted Cruz. The media is spinning it like that's normal. Now, four other states are canceling, and they're just going to give the delegates directly to Ted Cruz. This is incredible. Well, Coloradans are upset, and they're going to be there Friday, and so are Rob Dew, and so is Joe Biggs. And then we're going to go to Portland the next day. We're going to show you some of that footage where the left has announced with communist banners, no free speech, no Trump allowed. So this is pure tyranny, an attack on free speech on every front. Rob Dew, tell us about the events.
All right, so Friday, April 15th from 3 to 6, we're going to be at the Colorado GOP headquarters at 5950 South Willow Drive, and that's in Greenwood Village, Colorado. We're going to go there and support the rest of the GOP, who's mad as hell. 1 million GOPers are pissed off that they didn't get to cast their vote in for the president of the United States, for the Republican Party.
And imagine if a million black people have been disenfranchised. People are upset about that. Jim Crow laws, I am too. But what about what's happening now to everybody and this precedent? And let's be clear, this is about free speech, not even about Trump. This is very, very important. Everybody needs to be there, and everybody needs to get their friends and family to go there.
Portland State Students for Donald Trump, that'll start at 2 o'clock. Location will be the Smith Memorial Student Union. That's at 1825 Southwest Broadway in Portland, Oregon. So we're going to be out there as well, standing with these students who want to have this meeting in support of Donald Trump. That is their right. That is their freedom of speech.
And these bullies have been trying to stop it. So on Infowars.com, we're going to have an article up by tonight. breaking down the maps, where it is. Come out and support these reporters, also in free speech. Yep. But they're going to be wearing Trump hats and InfoWars shirts just to show the type of garbage that's going on. You've seen the clips, Biggs. We're going to play just a few clips of it now, of Portland. These people are scary.
Get InfoWars shirts!
Like what they just did to you, like,
What's incredible about Portland is that it's faculty there screaming at people saying you have no free speech.
The staff, yeah, the staff are yelling at people. They're like, shut up, sit down, we're going to tell you what's going on. And they said, if you have another event, we're going to come back. So here it is. There's going to be another event on Saturday. So are you going to be there? We'll see. We'll see if free speech gets under attack at Portland State University.
Those six brave people went and stood against the First Amendment fascism of the corporately George Soros-funded left. Let's have hundreds of people show up where they're slated speakers by the student group to stand up for free speech and stand up against this Maoist-level tyranny. Joe Biggs, one more time, tell folks the date of the Portland situation. Do it one more time for what's happening Friday.
So once again, Saturday the 16th at Portland State Students for Donald Trump. That'll be at 2 o'clock. That is the start time. I would arrive a little bit early and get ready to go in there. The location is at the Smith Memorial Student Union, and that's at 1825 Southwest Broadway.
The GOP protest in Colorado
will be at Greenwood Village, Colorado from 3 to 6.
Put all the address information and maps on in the article and in this description of the video.
All right, fantastic, folks. Hey, stand up for the First Amendment. Stand up for your voting rights. There should be an election in Colorado and other states. There should be a thing called voters. Soon they're going to say voters never existed and it's a conspiracy theory. I'm not joking. Now's the time to stand up for free speech and freedom of the press and voting or lose it all.
The reason I'm talking about earthquakes is I'm going to talk some about that in the next segment. I'm not somebody obsessed with volcanoes and earthquakes. Some people really are into that. They like those movies. And they're always worried about it. I guess you kind of do if you live in like California or something or Japan. But they are saying, all the seismologists, California is way overdue. It's going to be like an 8.0 or bigger. What will that do to the economy? But it's a parallel to the economy already. People just don't think it's going to happen until it happens, and we're lined up for the biggest group of bubbles we've ever seen. Even, you know, the Royal Bank of Scotland says, sell everything you've got, you know, into the world type stuff, now coming out of George Soros and others. And so I'm just asking, wow, you know, is that just hype, or how big is it going to be? Is there any way to avoid it? Peter Schiff was just getting into some of the numbers coming out. Peter?
Well, no, I was talking before the break about how investors still just don't get what's going on, because for the past several years, everybody's been positioned as if this recovery were real, that it was sustainable, and that the Fed could normalize interest rates and everything was going to be fine. So they've been buying dollars, they've been buying certain assets. And the first quarter of this year, investment returns, it was the worst quarter in 18 years for actively managed funds. Most hedge funds lost money, barely any made any money at all, because they still don't get it. They still don't understand what's changed. Meanwhile, at Euro Pacific Capital, we had one of our best quarters in years, probably since 2009, because we're positioned for reality. I've been saying for the last few years, as this bubble's been inflating, that this whole narrative has been wrong, that the Federal Reserve has not solved our problems, but exacerbated them.
And you said
them.
That before 2008, so let me ask you this. Speaking of earthquakes, you're famous for quoting, famous for this quote, 2008 was a tremor for the earthquake that's coming. Is that what you're still saying?
Yeah, and I've been saying that all along, even before 2008, because I saw 2008 coming, and unfortunately, I also saw how the government would respond to 2008. And they did exactly what I feared that they would do and what I warned they would do, and that is exactly why the real earthquake is still in our future. It's not in our past, and people have to prepare for that. And by the way, you know, silver hit a new high today for this year, for 2016. So people are starting to wake up. It's happening very slowly. But it's happening. And
I think Dent's really smart, and I agree with him on a lot of stuff. But when he thinks because gold is so finite, that's why it's not valuable. I mean, the laws of economics I've seen, that makes it more valuable. And it has industrial uses, and all these elites are hoarding it.
he's got it backwards. It's scarcity is what makes it so valuable, or one of the things that makes it so valuable. If it was abundant, if it was everywhere, then obviously it wouldn't have a lot of value. And the idea that because it's scarce, it can't function as money is completely ridiculous, because gold is divisible. I mean, you can always adjust the price of gold higher, so you never run out of it. There's always enough.
Well, what about this, though? We now know they've been manipulating gold and silver down, as you said many years ago was going on, and others did. They now admit that so much is rigged. So, like the stock markets, much of it, like the interest rates, currency rates. I mean, how does rigging tie into it? Because they can always come up with new tricks.
Yeah, well, you can only do that for so long. Look, if the government really could manipulate the gold market, gold wouldn't be at 1220. It would still be, down at 300 or lower where it was in 2000. If they can rig markets.
Well, we know they're trying, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, they try, but they're not going to succeed. The markets are much bigger. The fundamentals ultimately win out. They can succeed in delaying the inevitable, but all that does is make the inevitable bigger, right? So if the government is trying to prevent gold from going up, when it eventually does go up, it's going to go up even higher.
Well, that's what they say about earthquakes, too. They say the fact that California is way overdue means there's even more pressure when it finally hits. Are you saying it's the same for economics?
Yeah, I mean, those tremors are good because they take the pressure off the fault. You need the little tremors so you don't have a bigger quake. But think about wage and price controls. What happens when the government has a price control on something for a while because they try to cover up the symptoms of inflation, and then they give up and they take away the controls, and then you get a huge spike in price. So if the government's going to try to manipulate the market, it's not going to last. But a lot of the manipulation isn't really manipulation. It's just people being foolish. You've got big banks like Goldman Sachs shorting gold, telling their clients to short gold. A lot of people, unfortunately, listen to Goldman Sachs, and they're doing the wrong thing. So a lot of times the markets are just mispriced because so many people don't get it, just like all the people who were buying the subprime mortgages before the bottom dropped out of the market, or all the people who were buying those dot-com stocks for several years before they collapsed. So the same thing is going to happen now. There's a lot of people following.
Peter's Skype cut out for just a moment. We're trying to reconnect with him here at the end. It's my job's fun in many ways. It's also scary. But the good news is, time goes on. We're going to get to find out who's right in all this. Peter, your Skype cut out for a moment. But Europac.com, do you think it'll be evident that we're in a real global recession soon, in the next few months, or will it take later?
Well, look, I think it's more of a U.S.
All right, Peter Schiff is gone. Hey, it's okay. Skype cut out at the end. Thank you, Peter, for joining us. Europac.com, Alex Jones with Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Speaking of tremors, speaking of volcanoes, I'm going to hit some articles on that when we come back. Leanne McAdoo got an important report. I've been hearing air on that subject as well. We'll get into the economy, some military news, a lot more than our reporters on the ground in Denver, Colorado. There's a lot of amazing news up on Infowars.com. and PrisonPlanet.com right now. We're going to be covering some of it. But if you're watching us on television, you see our standard yellow star. We call it the sun that we orbit. Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, and then out into the gas giants. And the Kuiper Belt. And one of the biggest threats is out there between the gas giants. And that's the asteroid field. It's estimated that there's the equivalent of hundreds of planets worth of wreckage floating in orbit around the sun. And a lot of those get kicked out on different tracks, along with comets and other planetary visitors, and plunge into the Earth's surface. They even have serious Discovery Channel scientific programs where they now show satellite photos of the huge craters all over the world. Before the Shoemaker-Levy comet, was it Saturn it plunged into? Jupiter, yeah. I remember having Shoemaker and Levy on before they died in a car wreck, or the Shoemaker family. I've had Levy on after they died. Amateur, professional, quasi, finding that comet and then estimating that it would hit Jupiter. And then the comet blowing holes, six holes, as it broke up coming into the atmosphere, bigger than Earth. Some people even thought it might ignite, but it didn't, the gas giant, and turn it into a sun. In fact, if Jupiter got ignited, many estimate it would be a smaller second sun. That's what the whole 2001 Space Odyssey thing ends with, and then when Jupiter ignites into a sun and destroys the wormhole gate that's there, it's called Lucifer. So that's all the occultism of the establishment and how they flaunt it in everybody's face. There was even a leaked NASA plan to actually run that project. But I digress. It was blowing holes in the side of the planet, the gas giant. Go look it up for yourself. I'm going from memory here. Bigger than the Earth. Now, that's the universe we live in. And the United Nations voted back in Copenhagen when they were pushing World Government Conference 5-6 years ago that the sun does not affect climate. Well, we know it's the main driver of climate. Tectonic energies are clearly, according to all the scientists I've interviewed, the experts. Again, I've gone and interviewed the experts. They always say, oh, you're not a scientist. You can't speak to these things. Barbara Boxer talking down to people like they're idiots. Like she only has the knowledge. That's that MSNBC attitude that anybody else that doesn't do exactly what they say is dumb and they're so smart. Then you go meet one of their followers, they can hardly talk. They're just ruled by these arrogant crones that sit up on them as mob bosses trying to ban free speech and restrict all these liberties. And, oh, let's Bill Nye, the science guy, let's arrest anybody that disagrees with man-made climate change. Thought it was warming. And so what I'm getting at here is the next big force is tectonic. The next big heat source is the Earth, still molten from its creation and the pressures of its mass. There's a debate whether the moon has a molten center or not. Most scientists think it's probably cool by now. Doesn't have the pressures needed to continue to heat. But those are some of the mysteries of the universe. Those are some of the things that scientists are still trying to completely discover. But we're in a very active universe. Again, if you're a radio listener, you go to Infowars.com/show to see what I'm talking about. It adds another dimension, as I say, to the transmission. And then most experts agree, and this is the compendium of research, that the third driver of climate on the Earth, number one is the sun, number two is tectonic movement and heat, number three is the moon. The moon is huge. It controls the tides. It manipulates what's happening inside the Earth. It has a massive effect on when plants and animals release their pollen, when they mate, when the fish run. It's all known to be kind of the clock of the Earth. And also the space winds and the solar winds are blocked by the moon. Even though it's smaller than the Earth, when the winds go over it, they have radio telescope shots of this and magnetic field telescopes. It goes like a teardrop over it. And the moon, when properly positioned, completely blocks the Earth from solar radiation and space winds. Pretty amazing, huh? Or space winds coming from that direction. There's just all sorts of different types of radiation and fields and light and dark matter energy that they know is there. They can read it on meters. It's stronger than our energy, but they can't tell what it is because it's interdimensional. But they see the pressure wavelengths of whatever's in those other dimensions weighing in. And they have lower dimensional fields showing up and higher dimensional fields and then other dimensional fields and vortexes. And then we have the establishment telling us that men reading teleprompters, walking around on red carpets with foppish, sycophantic crowds, telling them they're gods. And these are the people that endanger our planet that have created all sorts of super high-tech weapons and now think they're God or genetically engineering every species they can get their hands on, that are creating cross-species chimeras. Chimera, potato, patata. And there's just no sense of restraint in the race for power. Because, well, if we create the new AI supercomputers, it'll merge with us, we'll live forever. And if we do all the genetic engineering randomly with gene guns, randomly splicing thousands of species a day at major laboratories, we'll find new super secret, and we'll implant the humans in humanoid cows and sheep that are part human and won't reject it. And the best part is the animals have no rights, and the humans have no rights, because they're not actually human or animal. And then the environmentalists are controlled by us through the globalist think tanks with Dr. Peter Singer. And PETA is really the Animal Liberation Front, and we're in control and guide the whole movement. Don't warn anybody about the real problems. See, we got it all figured out. They got it all figured out. They know what they're doing. And I was talking to my lawyer yesterday. Now, let's look at that headline for a second. What's that out of the Express? Yeah, London Express. Yeah, look at that. Scientists open mass cloning factory this year to clone cows, pets, and humans. I notice they always act like it hadn't really been developed yet. They've been cloning since the 30s with rabbits. They've been cloning humans, we know, since the 50s. And they just always, oh, we don't know if we can do that like we're children. And they've got all these weird cross-species animals you can buy that rich people are getting and stuff now. And you tell the general public that, they just roll your eyes. They have cross-species salmon that's three times bigger and they admit is going to extinct regular salmon already in the ocean. Oh, they magically just let it go. Oh, oops, they're playing God, folks. They're on power trips. They're playing dice, Russian roulette, on purpose for the nihilistic thrill of doing it all. And I've said it before, I'll say it again. I don't know if there was a real Atlantis. Plato said it was real. Other cultures did as well. Blew up out by the Atlantic Ocean. They found all sorts of weird isotopes in the rock that submarines have gotten in the different areas. But here's what I'm getting at. Whether it's comets or whether it's asteroids, you add in new threat matrices. Because previously, scientists said, oh, we believe every few million years, a comet or huge asteroid that causes an earth-changing event that darkens the skies for a few years, creates a mini ice age, and kills most of the life forms. We think it happens every million, 2 million years. Now scientists have gone and they've studied the rock in thousands of large craters, hundreds of humongous ones, bigger than Meteor Crater, you know, out in Arizona. And they know that it happens probably every couple hundred thousand years or more. Because they find ice ages in the ice core samples that weren't a couple thousand years long on the dormancy cycle of the sun every 10, 12,000 years. They're finding little ones and partial ones all over. And then they check the isotopes and they check the different compound minerals that are created. And they know the signature of even certain meteors and what they were made out of and what those meteors slash asteroids did. And so we're sitting here with the clock going, I mean, you talk about a global government. It should be a consortium of nations working together to have anti-comet and anti-asteroid defense systems. But see, they don't want you to have all that. There's a race to get all the power first for the elite, wall us off, dumb us down, cull us out with mind control and bioweapons. While they're all racing as fast as they can to get life extension, and then they think supercomputers will be so fast and so great, they'll just manifest all these super technologies overnight in the singularity, when the singularity is just something that Ray Kurzweil came up with, who thinks he's going to resurrect his dead dad with his dad's diary and papers. No, Kurzweil, you're not going to resurrect your dead dad with that. Maybe in the future you could record everything in his brain, have a copy of it, and claim that was really him. But it won't be his essence, his soul, his spirit. But your daddy ain't coming back, whack job. And you're not going to become the first God. Look around you, brother. There is a real God. You ain't it. I ain't it. You arrogant, narcissistic loon bag. I deal with so many crazy people in my life, and they're savage, they're nuts, they think they're invincible. They're easy to defeat like a lobotomized zombie, but you still got to deal with them. It's like having one in your backyard that's crawling along, and you can't sit there and have lemonade. You're going to fall asleep. It's going to chew your throat out. They just think they're so smart. The arrogance, the delusion, because we've created an artificial world where people don't have to live in the real confines of the real world. People started fights. They've pushed people around. They've done stuff, and they've never had to get their nose broken for it. And that's why they want a nanny state, so all these little babies are delusional and don't live in the real world and don't understand what's really going on and don't have any real ideas about what they're dealing with. So they're not worried about NSA spying. They're not worried about checkpoints. They're not worried about forced vaccines. They're not worried about GMO. They're not worried about anything because they are delusional until they get cancer or until they get a neurological disorder. And then they go to the races and sit in the stands, you know, dying of cancer. And everybody waves at them when they go for the jog, the 10K to raise money. And then they feel like a victim and are a movie star while they're dying and, you know, get all into it. And they've got a whole program for you. And, oh, the end of humanity's coming, and we'll all be little rock stars during it, and we all knew our species was bad, and we're all just going to accept it. So you think nothing's going to happen to you till it's happening to you. And I'm telling you, folks, it is happening to you. Our children are being brain damaged and brainwashed by the TV and the screen time. The GMO is killing us and changing our DNA. The elite are like psycho mad scientists on PCP. There are hundreds of volcanoes suddenly becoming active at a level they've never seen in modern history. There are all sorts of sinkholes forming everywhere, earthquakes happening all over the place, crazy mass die-offs and stuff going on, all sorts of secret testing going on. The elite are trying to kill the planet, as best I can tell, while they claim they're trying to save it. High school textbooks we've shown you teach children that there is chemtrailing going on, and that they're doing it to save the Earth. I got sent links this weekend by friends that it was on Weather Channel admitting they're chemtrailing us and how they do it for our own good. See, it doesn't exist, but we're doing it. There is a global government, but we're doing it. There is a secret Department of Energy program, but it's not what the kooks say. It's for your own good. And then we find out all over the world, the aluminum's getting so high, plants can't grow and are dying. Why are you doing this New World Order? Well, you come to kill, steal, and destroy. I mean, I'm not saying you're the devil. That's what the Bible says he does. You want to come to kill, steal, and destroy. And you go about like a lion roaring, seeing who you may devour. Because I used to think that was like in, you know, Friday the 13th movies where the guy's woman's running and she falls down on purpose and then crawls on her, you know, legs. Oh, don't get me. I used to think, oh, that's made up. Then I've actually seen video and footage now and, you know, crime scene stuff where that's actually what a lot of people do is they fall down. Someone walks in their house with a butcher knife. Grown men just go, and the person gets to stab them. That was bred into you. The wimpiest person 100 years ago, I don't care if it was the U.S., Africa, Germany, Mexico, I don't care where you were. You come pull a knife on anybody, they're going to fight you because they got an instinct. But see, they flipped the instinct off. I mean, somebody walks here with a butcher knife to attack me. This table's going over on them. I'm going to just literally start baring my teeth and just go completely ape on them. And it's not because I'm even a tough guy. I'm normal. You want to kill me? How about you die? And that's what I'm telling the New World Order. Listen, I see you. Man, you're ugly. Man, you stink. Man, you're evil. Wow. If there was the devil before, you've now manifested it. You're at Satan's real. And you know what? I look at you, you snot-nosed, demon-eyed maggot. I'm going to get my hands around your neck with God's help. And we're going to absolutely, metaphysically twist your head off your little shoulders. All I know is I don't want to be around this or a part of it. And I've got all this earthquake news. 5 major earthquakes in 48 hours. The seismologists warn catastrophic mega earthquakes are coming. Scientists fear the big one is coming. 4 major earthquakes, 48 volcanoes going crazy. You name it. And that's the thing. The globalists aren't even in disguise. You fool me with your kisses. You look, I'm going to do a whole special report on the volcanoes and the earthquakes and all the craziness. I want to hit this Russia story that's on Infowars.com. It's pretty important. I'll do 5 minutes the next hour. Then David Knight takes over with our crew. He's going to be on the ground. Or they're on the ground there in Denver. That's only coming up here in about 10 minutes or so. Briefly, this is a listener-supported broadcast. Everybody knows that. That's how we fund the operation, and we sell a lot of really great products. And you heard me, you know, talking to Peter Schiff earlier. about how our audience just gets bigger, but expanded funds don't come in. And we're doing okay. We can pay our crew and things, but it gets really hard to do more. And it just gets down to the fact that I want to be able to continue what we're doing and hopefully expand. And then I know things are probably going to get worse down the road. So I'm thinking, man, I just want to keep where I'm at. And so please shop with the good guys. Plant a garden this year. We have the widest selection of non-GMO heirloom quality seeds, from fruit trees right down to corn, right down to wheat, right down to tobacco. You name it, InfoWarsStore.com, shortwave radios, Hillary for President shirts, Molon Labe shirts, hundreds of others. And we have some of the biggest deals ever on products like the great Brain Booster, Naturally Healthily. That is BrainForce at InfoWarsLife.com. It is 45% off retail, 25% off sales price. We always pretty much have stuff at sales price, but it's 25% off sales price. That's 45% off retail, $22 for a nootropic that we could eat. I could sell it for $40 and sleep really good at night, because we got to have profit to operate. That's like when I sell colloidal silver for $9.95. It should be $24. I mean, it's really good. Try it out for yourself. Know you're supporting the broadcast. We also have Survival Shield Nation Iodine X2, the good halogen that's so important to block out the bad halogens. Just what it's done for me has been so game-changing. It's amazing. Find out why it's so special. I keep forgetting we have 10% off for everybody that signs up for AutoShip for different products at InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com. 10% off, and then you can just cancel any time. But something you know you want every month, like the Wake Up America high-quality coffee, super high-quality organic volcanic soil-grown southern Mexico, Chiapas. It's like Guatemalan, but better. It's my favorite coffee. Very rich, very delicious. Arabica. And you can get 10% off on any item when you sign up for AutoShip. Everything's free shipping on $50 or above. I need to mention that more often. And we've also got DNA Force with a patented form of antioxidant CoQ10, BioPQQ, digestive enzymes, patented types, immune boosting, astragalus root, pomegranate extract, plant-based resveratrol, and so many other things. That's why it's such an amazing nutraceutical, and your purchase makes it all possible. And don't forget, if you want to get videos and articles that are exclusive and things that we send out on other platforms that try to censor us, you need to sign up to get the free email alerts at Infowars.com/newsletter. We also send a lot of promo codes and things that are exclusive just to the newsletter, Infowars.com/newsletter. InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com. And please don't forget InfoWarsHealth.com. That's the full spectrum, 400-plus products of the amazing folks at Youngevity, whether it's Beyond Tangy Tangerine 2.0, or their original, my favorite, or whether it's Pollen Burst or Osseo FX or the Alex Pack, they call it discounted. You can get free shipping there when you sign up for AutoShip as well. And you can get 30% off when you sign up and become a distributor. It's like $30 to become a distributor. Then you get, it's like Sam's Club or whatever. Then you get big discounts and a lot more at InfoWarsHealth.com or InfoWarsTeam.com. It's basically a clone of the site, but it's more geared towards becoming a distributor. InfoWarsTeam.com. We're all in this together. When you support our sponsors, it really helps us, obviously. It's the oxygen of this operation. Some stations don't carry it. A lot of them are. Support our local affiliates. Fourth hour coming up, InfoWars.com/show to find all the free podcasts, video links, and the rest of the fourth hour. Stay with us. I'll tell you this, though. We're only going to get in a worse position groveling to the globalists. We got to stand up to them as hardcore as we can. That is the safest path out of this tyranny. All right. Let me hit some of the other news. I mentioned this, but I want to get to this right now. Exclusive Colorado caucus volunteers, where our folks are going to be on in like 5 minutes, Rob Dew and others. Colorado caucus volunteers, ballot errors hurt Trump delegate candidates, could have violated the state rules. Well, of course they did. Volunteers of the Colorado Republican Assembly are coming forward with evidence that indicates that their state delegate selection process was riddled with errors that disadvantaged some Donald Trump supporters who were running to become national delegates. Well, yeah, they blocked out all the real delegates and then just chose them. And then Breitbart is looking at this not from a criminal mindset, you know, trying to look fair, saying, oh, and then they just didn't get to get voted for. It was wrong. No, it was all fixed. That's how Cruz got all the delegates. Cruz didn't get all the, every delegate wasn't for him. Even they tried to rig it. You just can't magically have all of them for you. Canceling the election was rigging number one. Then they didn't want anybody for him. And they're like, oh, maybe the ballots weren't right. Oh, think so? Think so, really? Ted Cruz took all 34 delegates last week in a process that closed down traditional caucus voting to the public. Oh, closed down traditional voting. No big deal. A handful of volunteers spoke to Breitbart News about the process. I'm the former chairman of the Pueblo County Republican Party and the person who developed the states of national delegates for Donald Trump team. Colorado GOP website was filled with errors posted about the national delegates. Was it errors? That's the fog of war to confuse you. Nancy Mizell told Breitbart News. Let's get Nancy Mizell on, because you're going to see it in more states. Mizell took a photograph of a ballot. Yeah, we covered this last week on a YouTube video, or this Monday. In Congressional District 7. And see, I'm not mad at my reporters. I don't have as big a staff as Breitbart. I wanted them to do a story on this. Mizell, because we have the video, took a photograph of the ballot in Congressional District 7 that included only the ballot numbers of delegate candidates, not the names and candidates required by the state bylaws. It just goes on from there. I mean, you talk about hanky-panky. This is it. Now, let's continue here. Here is another article that Steve Watson did dealing with Hillary Clinton. I actually did say Hillary wrong there. That wasn't a joke. Phone transcript proves Hillary lied about Benghazi attack. Clinton told Egyptian Prime Minister, we know the attack in Libya has nothing to do with the film. A transcript of the telephone conversation released by the State Department proves once and for all that Hillary Clinton knowingly lied about the Benghazi attacks in the American diplomatic compound. The transcript obtained by a FOIA request by Judicial Watch, they do such a good job, details a call immediately after the attack between then Secretary of State and then Egyptian Prime Minister. We know the attack in Libya had nothing to do with the film, Clinton told him. It was planned attack, not a protest. The Prime Minister went on, you're not kidding. Based on the information we saw, we believe that group had claimed responsibility for this affiliate with Al-Qaeda. Well, it's who they had running security in the area. It was all staged. That's just another lie she got caught in. Another lie. All right. He's getting suited up. He's loaded for bear. And nothing on earth's going to stop him. David Knight coming out of the bullpen in T-minus 3 minutes, 7 seconds. I'm Alex Jones. Join us in the epic fight for human liberty. Join us in the InfoWar.
It's April 15th. Do you know what that means? Or do you? It may not be the same day you think it is. Tower of Power. And, of course, the power to tax is the power to destroy. That's Tower of Power, Tax to the Max, one of my favorite songs, especially this time of year. You know, today is April 15th. That may be the day you think you have to file your taxes. But in a good example of how even the tax deadline is convoluted and loaded with exceptions. Listen to this. I wasn't even aware of this until today myself. Tax day will not be today, but will be Monday, April the 18th. Traditionally, it's on April the 15th, unless it falls on a weekend. However, in the District of Columbia, they are celebrating Emancipation Day. Now, Emancipation Day falls on Saturday. You would say, well, why don't they just celebrate it on Monday? No, no. The law says that if it falls on a weekend, it's observed on the day that is closest, the weekday that is closest to it. That would mean that since it comes on the 16th, they have to celebrate it on the 15th and not on the 18th. Oh, okay. So therefore, they're going to move that because in Washington, D.C., they're celebrating Emancipation Day. Do you feel emancipated? You know, I don't feel emancipated with this, but it gets even better, okay? Gets even better because for those people who are doing returns in Maine or Massachusetts, they get another day because that's a holiday this coming Monday. The deadline will be April the 19th because they're celebrating Patriots Day, which actually was the move against Concord and Lexington was actually on April the 19th, but they're celebrating it on April the 18th. How's that for the federal government? But, of course, if you need more time, you can always get Form 4868, and you can fill that out and send that to the appropriate place. But you need to check the instructions to see where you're going to send that. Have you had enough? I've had enough. You know, I ran with the Libertarian Party, what was it, about 20 years ago? 20 years ago, exactly. Ran for Congress. First thing I said was, let's get rid of the income tax, okay? It was something that Harry Brown, who was running for president at the time, first time he said, you know, the income tax doesn't fund our government. It only funds a very small part of the government. We have other taxes that are there. We could make other taxes instead of the income tax. We don't necessarily have to get our taxes through the income tax, right? We can get it through a flat tax, a sales tax. But you got to be careful when they come up with these alternative plans. They're typically going to add them and not replace them. I understand that, okay? But still, if you just cut out the income tax, cut out the IRS, what would happen to our country? Well, you know, you would really only have to go back, and it varies. We've looked at the numbers, and you only have to go back typically, especially because the government is growing so quickly, you typically only have to go back about 6 or 7 years. And that's how fast our government is growing, and that's how little the income tax contributes to the operation of our government. So could you live with a government that was the size it was 6 or 7 years ago in order to get rid of the income tax? Now is the time to think about that. You really should think about that. And, you know, let me just throw this in as a historical aside. I don't want to get too far off of the track here. But Emancipation Day, okay, great. Ending slavery was a great thing. But Emancipation Proclamation didn't free a single slave. Look it up. Abraham Lincoln was very careful to only free the slaves in the states that were still under the Confederate States of America. All the slaves that were in states that he controlled, he did not free. Which is why Ulysses Grant kept his slaves until after the Civil War, when they were eliminated by the 14th Amendment. So Emancipation Day itself is also a fraud, and I don't feel very emancipated today as we're looking at the taxes. Now, look at this article here. Insurers are warning that losses from Obamacare are unsustainable. And I think that's interesting because, you know, Justice Roberts in the Supreme Court told us that Obamacare isn't an unconstitutional mandate. No, it's a tax. Yeah, isn't it? It's a tax, like Admiral Akbar. It's a tax. It's a tax. It's a tax. Well, that tax, which is an onerous part of doing your income tax, is also something that is not working out very well. Health insurance companies are amplifying their warning about the financial sustainability of the Obamacare marketplace as they seek approval for premium increases next year in the Affordable Care Act. Now, got to have even more increases. We had a slew of increases at the onset, but it still isn't working. They need even more with all of the mandates, because it's not just mandated that you buy it. It's also mandated that celibate nuns have to get birth control insurance, okay, or abortion insurance. Insurers say that they're losing money on their Obamacare plans at a rapid rate. Some have begun to talk about dropping out of the marketplace altogether. This is a story from The Hill. Something has to give, says an expert on the health law at the Kaiser Family Foundation, said either insurers will drop out or they will raise premiums. In the short term, there is a growing likelihood that insurers will push for substantial premium increases, creating a political problem for Democrats in an election year. You think? Yeah, maybe it will. We have an amazing admission from Google that is buried in a patent for self-driving cars. I'm going to get to that in just a minute. Before I do, I want to comment, because Alex has played several times, this clip going back and forth of Barbara Boxer browbeating a guy who is speaking against climate, man-made climate change. And I thought it was interesting in that clip, she says to one guy, well, what are you? And he goes, well, I'm a philosopher. Well, why are we talking to you? We need to have scientists here. Well, you know, Barbara Boxer wants to play the credentials game. Barbara Boxer is not a scientist. She's got a BS in economics. So she worked as a stockbroker and then as a journalist. Bill Nye, the science guy, okay, he's kind of a science guy. He's got an engineering degree like me. He's got a mechanical engineering degree. But, you know, the problem is I don't think he learned too much, because one of the first things they teach you in engineering is that you got to know what your tolerances are. Bill, okay? So, yeah, we can look at it and we can say the obvious thing is that the sun has the biggest effect on our climate. But even when they go back and play with these numbers, they say the earth is going to melt if we've got a 2 degree or a 1 degree increase in temperature. Yeah, I'm with John Coleman, the guy that Alex has interviewed multiple times, the guy who was the founder of the Weather Channel. This is a guy who understands tolerances. This is a guy who grew up looking at the weather, studying the weather, trying to predict the weather. He knows you're not going to be able to predict the weather, especially with these untested models. 10 years, 50 years, decades out, you're not going to be able to predict it that way. It's absolute total nonsense. And to say that you're going to have the sky fall in if there's a change in 1 degree, you don't have base measurements that fall within that tolerance. He said over and over again, he said, look, when I was growing up, we had these thermometers. You may have seen them. You know, they didn't have the nice little digital readouts. You get a digital readout, you think it is 100% accurate. It's not. It's not. When people stop using analog devices like slide rules and thermometers with mercury in it, they seem to lose their understanding of what the tolerances are on these devices. So when you've got something that's a mercury thermometer, you understand you've got parallax error with it. You've also got error that can be introduced based on where you're doing the temperature measurements. And, of course, they rig that as well. You can get a very different measurement if you're measuring out in the countryside in a forest than if you're measuring in the city or on an airport tarmac, which is where they put a lot of these in. So, yeah, Bill Nye, if he is a scientist, maybe he's not a scientist. I ought to put that disclaimer. Remember he had, it was Robert Young, the guy who played Marcus Welby, M.D., and he started cutting ads for Big Pharma, and he said, I'm not a doctor, actually. I just play one on television. Well, Bill Nye should have that same disclaimer, especially because even if he's an engineer, he doesn't know anything about tolerances. But getting back to the irony of this, Barbara Boxer, the irony of her coming down on somebody's credentials because they say they're a philosopher, and then the irony of her saying to this priest who's trying to explain something to her about the Pope doesn't have authority to speak as a scientist after she's just dressed this other guy down as being a philosopher and having no authority to talk on the issue. Then she gets on this priest by saying, well, wait a minute, don't you follow the Pope? Don't you care what the Pope says? And it's like, hey, lady, the Pope is not a scientist either. Neither are you. And so she says, well, you disagree with the Pope. I think you ought to talk with Reverend Wilson. He goes, well, by the way, he is not a scientist either. So when we look at science and when we look at where this is going, let's take a look at what Google is saying and this amazing admission, I think. This is a patent. And the way it was put out by Daily Mail, I thought was very amusing. The headline from Daily Mail sounds like they really are on to something. It says, Google's self-driving cars may soon predict what drivers are going to do next. Wow. Wow. This is like a pre-crime data analysis or something? They jacked into your mind? They're going to know where you're going to go? No. Actually, they're coming up with a patent to reveal plans where sensors will be able to look at your turn signals. That's the mind reading. That's the prediction of what drivers are going to do. These self-driving cars are going to be able to look at your turn signals and predict your actions. Who would have thought that could happen? Isn't science amazing? Stay with us, boys and girls. It gets more interesting even as we go through this. They're going to look at turn signals and at braking lights, okay? Now, the Daily Mail, after being absolutely astonished that this is something that's going to be coming, I looked at this and I go, you mean the self-driving cars can't look at brake lights? They can't look at turn signals now? Why do they have them on the road? Maybe this explains why they've been involved in so many accidents at a rate that is an order of magnitude more than a human driver would have. But of course, they bring hit in the back, okay? So it's never their fault legally, except when they just turned into the school bus it wasn't a school bus, it was a public bus. That they actually kind of sort of admitted to being at fault with. But I tell you, if they can't read the brake signals, then that may explain why they have so many accidents, because it's going to be a little bit late in terms of reacting to this. So they're going to slam on the brakes and somebody's going to slam into them. They say details of this engineering patent filed by Google with its autonomous vehicles have not come out yet in full, and they've got a full engineering drawing there of the sensors that are going to be there. Isn't that amazing? Stay with us. We're going to have more amazing science news when we come back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're going to be joining our reporters in Denver. Of course, there's going to be a protest coming up at 3 o'clock. I think it's Mountain Time, okay? So it's not going to be happening at the time we connect with them, but they're going to be there at the steps of the White House, the Capitol building in Colorado, in Denver, Colorado. If you want to go to that, it's going to be 3 p.m. Mountain Time. That's the west steps of the Colorado State Capitol in Denver, Colorado. That is a protest of the disenfranchisement of the GOP voters in the so-called primary that they had, or the caucus, or I don't know what you call that. I guess it's not an election, it's the selection that they had. And we're going to talk to them about what happened last night in New York as well. I want to get back to the amazing technology news here, but Before I do, we've got an amazing special. We have 25% off, an additional 25% off of our sale price of BrainForce at InfoWarsLife.com. That totals up to 45% off of the retail price. That's an unprecedented special that we have on BrainForce. Get something that helps you to focus your thoughts without making you jittery, without keeping you up at night. BrainForce uses natural brain activation ingredients like yerba mate extract and alpha GPC. Some ingredients in BrainForce are prescription only in Europe. And of course, we have hundreds of five-star reviews that you can read for yourself at InfoWarsLife.com. Again, an unprecedented special for BrainForce. 25% off of our sale price, 45% off of the retail price at InfoWarsLife.com. I was just talking about the self-driving cars and the fact that they're about to get even smarter because they're going to be able to recognize brake lights and turn signals. And it's amazing when you look at the engineering diagrams here for their patent where they're going to do this. They're going to do this, folks. These cars cannot currently recognize brake lights and turn signals, which explains a lot in their driving record. But look at how complicated this is. They've got all these devices all over this thing. It's like, you know, you have a pair of eyes. And I guarantee you, it's going to be a long time before this thing can predict better than you can what's going on in the road. They say it's going to enable these driverless cars to anticipate the movements on the roads. Well, kind of, sort of. There's going to be a lot of other issues involved, too, because there's more than just brake lights and turn signals. If you've been driving and you're still alive, you understand that, okay? They say earlier this week, engineers and safety advocates warned self-driving cars are more likely to hinder than to help public safety because of unsolved technical issues. You think? Now we see they're starting to work on a patent to recognize turn signals. But of course, they also point out in the same article from Daily Mail, Google is pushing U.S. Congress to give the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration new powers to grant its special expedited permission. No, these are exceptions to safety rules, okay? They keep telling us, we're going to end all traffic accidents. Nobody's going to die on the roads. And yet, we need to have the federal government exercise its authority to preempt the powers of the state and local communities to protect their people and waive all the safety regulations. How's that? Because why? Because Google wants it for their profits. But it's not just Google. The government wants it as well. Look at this article we've got from Kurt Nimmo today on InfoWars.com. The tech community denounces as ludicrous and dangerous a new technically illiterate proposal coming from our senators. Now, there's a lot of connection between this new proposal and what Google is trying to do. Because you need to understand that we need to stop calling them self-driving cars. We need to call them the Internet of Things cars. Because they're going to have the vehicle infrastructure mandated black boxes on your cars so they can tax and track you and they can control your movement. That's what they want to do. And that's what they're working on to mandate into our phones, into our computers. They've been doing it for a very long time with the cooperation of Apple, Microsoft, Google, and other corporations. They passed CISPA to remove their legal liability from you suing them for spying on you and turning the information over to the law enforcement. So now they're going to go the next step and mandate that these companies do it and pull it out into the open and tell everybody that, hey, after all these years of saying, you know, we're not watching you, you're a paranoid conspiracy theorist. If you think that that camera on your monitor is looking at you, you're crazy. You must be an Alex Jones show listener. And now we got the FBI bragging about the fact that he does that. Okay? So the mask is coming off. They're now bragging about it. They're openly talking about it. And they're going to openly do it and mandate it. And these corporations want it that way because they don't want the liability. That's what CISPA was about. They called it CISA, okay? So that's really what's going on. This is the way the people in engineering refer to it, okay? They say it basically outlaws end-to-end encryption. One other person says, this is easily the most ludicrous, dangerous, technically illiterate proposal I've ever seen. A computer security consultant said, this is a work of complete ignorance. It is a work of Richard Burr and Dianne Feinstein, who say no one should be above the law. Well,
we're on the march.
Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to be joining our reporters in Denver, Rob Dew and Joe Biggs and my son are there covering the protest. It's going to be starting at 3 p.m. Mountain Standard Time at the west steps of the Colorado State Capitol building in Denver, Colorado. Of course, they're going to be protesting what happened in the so-called primary that they had there. We're going to be going to them live in just a moment. As we were on break, Kit Daniels came in and handed me a story that just went up on Infowars.com. Agenda 21. Developers are planning a car-free 30-story condo in Austin. See, here it is. It's all part of Agenda 21. If you're going to control people's movements, if you're going to track their movements, if you're going to concentrate people into the cities, you need to make it car-free. You need to be able to control their movements. And, of course, this is, folks, you need to understand that it is nothing less than all-out war against our freedom. One of the first things you do is you control the movements of people. You put in additional ways to tax them. Now, we're going to talk to our reporters in Denver. Before we do, I wanted to give you a couple of political stories that are out here. This is from The Hill, a report that almost half of all super PAC money came from just 50 donors. Now, that explains a lot, doesn't it? Doesn't that explain the selection of delegates, the careful screening of people that are going to be allowed to participate in this convoluted and very opaque process that they had there? It was absolutely a ridiculous process if you take a look at it. Having people stand up and give a 10-minute statement to say, never Trump, or my number is such and such, vote for me. And they didn't put people's names on the ballot, which is one of the many things that in this article that we have, Patrick Cowley of Breitbart, Colorado caucus volunteers are saying ballot errors hurt Trump delegate candidates, could have violated state rules. They say that it's going to be significant enough that not only does it violate Republican Party rules, but they believe it's going to be challenged legally. Things like this, for example, the ballot shall include the presidential candidate each candidate for national delegate is pledged to support. Oh, that wasn't there, was it? It also didn't put their names there either, okay? And, of course, it just put numbers there, but then some people didn't get their numbers put there. They got some numbers listed twice. Others were omitted. So it's a very, very convoluted system. But here's the bottom line, folks. It's like 50 people are spending most of the money on the election. 50 donors are half of all the super PAC money. This is according to the Washington Post, 50 donors and their families. And they say some of the biggest contributors so far have been hedge fund manager Tom Steyer, who is fighting climate change. He has put in $17 million into a super PAC that supports candidates on climate change, that are fighting climate change, that are trying to set up a world governance based on carbon taxes. Steyer has pledged to spend more than the $74 million he gave during the 2014 elections. He gave $74 million. Now, this is an investment, folks. When Karl Rove was talking to, had his call, and some people said, hey, it looks like he's softening up to Trump. What he was doing was he was talking to, and they put it in there, his investors as to how they could preserve their candidates in office if Donald Trump were at the top of the ticket. They are investors. They are not doing this because they are passionate about preserving individual liberty. They're not doing this because they're passionate about maintaining the Constitution and our Bill of Rights, or because they want to overturn unconstitutional mandates like Obamacare. They're doing this as an investment. So you've got a guy like this who is the heaviest hitter in all these super PACs, and only 50 families are providing half of the money to all these super PACs. This guy put in $74 million last time. He's going to invest more this time because he's probably going to be in some of these carbon credit exchanges, as Alex Jones was talking about. It was Enron that started all of this scheme. And, of course, Bill Nye that was talking about that, saying, hey, you know, Enron was a criminal organization. We ought to make people who talk about climate change and deny it, we ought to make them criminals as well. Now, also in that, of course, are the big hitters for Ted Cruz. Other hedge fund managers like Robert Mercer and Paul Singer are also listed in the big donors. When we look at the delegates, we've got Ben Carson coming out and defending this, and I'm going to go to Rob in just a moment. He asked, why do we have the Electoral College anymore? And what he was doing was saying, I'm not happy with the way these delegates are being selected. And I'm not either. And we've talked about this many times, but there's a reason that we have the Electoral College, besides the fact that Not just GOP rules, okay? It's actually in the Constitution. It's the same reason we have senators and not just representatives. The representatives are supposed to represent the people. They're proportional based on population. The senators are supposed to represent the states. Why do you have that? I saw a firsthand example of that in a county that I lived in North Carolina. It bordered the university town for the University of North Carolina. They had a lot of people that moved in and in a high concentration spilled over into this previously rural county that had nothing but farmers in it. They had had a situation where they had elected representatives to the county government on a regional basis. But when these people who were political lefty activists spilled in from the university town, started moving into that county, they changed the rules. They said, you know what? We're just going to elect all the county commissioners at large, at large. Guess who got all the county commissioners? That little enclave of people at the top. What did they do? They enacted restrictions. So these people who had been there in many cases with their farms for over 100 years, 150 years, could not do anything with their land. They couldn't subdivide it. They couldn't sell off a portion of it because these people up in this little corner in this little suburban area were dictating to these people who had been there for many generations. That's the reason you've got states having power. They wanted to divide power and not just give it to the people, and we didn't want to have just a direct democracy. So again, Ben Carson's a great guy, but he's really confused about the issue. It doesn't have anything to do with the Electoral College. It has to do with the crooked rules of the GOP. And so now we go to our reporters in Denver, Rob Dew.
Hi, David. Rob Dew reporting for Infowars.com. Just outside of the Capitol of Colorado. This is the western side. This is where people will be showing up in about an hour and a half to protest the GOP's theft of their caucus. They basically, the 1 million people in this state did not get to vote and select, choose a president, a presidential candidate for the Republican Party, and they're pissed. So there's at least 500 people pledged on the Facebook page that are going to be coming here. And also, turn of events.
I got to interrupt you, Rob, because I would say that they have turned the caucus into a carcass, haven't they? We're looking at the rotting carcass of democracy.
And I just want to point out, we seem to have this fence wall thing coming out. Something they're setting up over here. I don't know what. It might be a 420 festival. And look, they put up fences everywhere to keep people out.
They do believe in fences, don't they?
Once again, we see the fence or wall at play to keep people out and keep people in. And, this is the kind of stuff we just need on the border. Yeah. But, so people are going to be showing up on these steps. This is the biggest side of the Capitol right here. All the others are slow. This has a nice big yard. There's a spire over here running up the center. And it should be pretty interesting of what's going to happen today.
So it's going to be about an hour and a half from
videos from yesterday, David.
It's going to be about an hour and a half from right now. Is that right? About an
correct.
Hour.
Correct. Yeah. And okay. I guess we'll plan on hooking up with the nightly news.
Okay.
About 4 o'clock your time, or 5 o'clock their time, 4 o'clock our time, and it should be in full swing at that point.
All right. Good. We're going to have that on the nightly news tonight. Tell us what happened last night in New York at the. I guess it was the Occupy Wall Street people protesting Trump. We saw some of the videos. We saw it got pretty hot and heavy with that one guy who's trying to educate them about the Second Amendment. They didn't like that.
Yeah, they didn't like that. He showed up with his orange sandwich board and passing out flyers saying, ISIS is here. You need to be prepared. You need to know how to fire a gun. And two ladies started yelling at him at first. And they were screaming at him, go, go. And then they started screaming more things at him. And then this guy comes up, puts his hands up, and just starts bumping him with his chest. And then another girl, who I think Biggs says she's with Black Lives Matter, grabbed his cards and threw them. And then they started pushing him, and it escalated from there. But I didn't see him attack anybody first at all. I saw those guys come up, and, they don't like those types of voices. They don't want to hear about the Second Amendment. They don't want to hear about real freedom.
Yeah.
They want to talk about their fake canned freedom, where nobody's really free. Everybody's just stuck in a socialist box.
Well, he's absolutely right. If there's an ISIS attack there in New York, their Black Lives Matter tactics and getting up and chest bumping these guys isn't going to be very effective, is it, Rob?
No, not very. Yeah, they're going to take one look at that and probably shoot them if that comes to happen with a bunch of ISIS guys. Biggs, come on in here. What was your opinion of what we saw last night? We didn't see too many other acts of violence. I know a few protesters got into the hotel. We weren't weren't actually around for that. It was a big area that was that the protests were going on, so we were covering a lot of ground, and that happened really quick, and that was quickly squashed by the police.
Yeah, I mean, I was actually standing behind the guy as he was moving forward, filming. I was actually standing there with Jesse Waters, a guy from O'Reilly. And all of a sudden, we heard screaming, ISIS is here. And I was looking around, and I see the guy, he's handing out flyers up in the air, and he goes, you need to learn how to protect yourself. That's what the Second Amendment's for. You need to go out, learn how to shoot a gun. And like you said, these people just start jumping up in his face, kind of pushing him, chest bumping him, and all that. Then one of the top Black Lives Matter girls, she's been to the White House before, she jumps in his face, starts cussing him out, starts pushing him again. Some other people do it. Next thing you know, it just push, push, push. Someone gets decked, hits the ground. As they're pushing the guy back with the Trump hat on, they almost push him into a guy who's in a wheelchair. You know, I mean, it was completely crazy. I mean,
but you guys don't realize that was all Donald Trump's fault. You know, like Ted Cruz said, you know, he's provoking all this. He wasn't the provocateur, I don't think. Certainly what he was doing was far less than what we've seen the Bernie Sanders people do going to a Trump rally. And they've been far more aggressive, far more in people's faces. He wasn't doing anything. He's just standing there saying something. And they were the ones who got physical. They were the ones who got aggressive with him in spite of what Ted Cruz would say.
I mean, I felt more safe on the Trump protester side, the pro-Trump guys, than I did in the anti-Trump. I mean, if your views differ for them in any way, they become violent, they become to verbally abuse you, scream at you, cuss at you, and then everyone, they're like, get this guy over here, da da da, and they all just swarm around you and just start screaming at you. That's not peaceful, you know, when you're suppressing people because I have a different viewpoint than you, and you think you can jump in here and, like, bully people and push them around. That's completely and totally out of control. That's not what America is supposed to be. And it sure as hell not going to happen under my watch.
Yeah, they were hanging a Donald Trump in effigy. They had another guy dressed as Donald Trump with a sign saying, you know, you can beat me for this much with a stick. You know, all kinds of love and
happiness
coming out from the liberal left over there in Manhattan. But, you know, other than that, it didn't get – we were at the Trump side when this other Black, I guess, Bernie supporter showed up and wanted to know – he got triggered by Make America Great Again because he was having a problem.
He's shirt. He's like, oh, I bet you guys won't punch me. I bet you won't punch me. And then the cops came over and they're like, all right, this is enough, man. You're starting
like, time to
agonize.
Yeah.
And he goes, all right, I hope I see you guys in the alley. Without your badge on, he's like, I'm going to start beating that A, you know, and it starts just like cussing at him, saying he was threatening, and, you know, to jump him in an alleyway if you ever saw him alone. Yeah. Out of control. That's not peaceful.
Yeah. And the cops were very well reserved. I can't believe he didn't get arrested for doing that because he was pushing the cops. He was verbally cussing them. He was threatening them. And, you know, I didn't see any Trump supporters doing that.
Yeah, that was the thing we noticed when we were in Washington and New York. I mean, the police there, they're so experienced with all these different demonstrations. They were pretty chill in New York and D.C. It was in Pennsylvania where they went totally overboard and crazy. It wasn't in the big cities like that where they deal with this every day.
Yeah, they actually had a pretty good plan. The way they kept traffic flowing the whole time. I think traffic only at one point. And, you know, they had areas on either side that were gated off, somewhere you could stand and somewhere that they wanted you to keep moving. And I actually thought they did a really good job with, you know, not much notice. One thing's interesting though, people are like, oh, this is spontaneous. No, we were there talking with Anthony yesterday. Yeah, it was yesterday. And they stopped with these cabs. They got generators. They got sound systems. They got printed signs. It was very well organized yesterday. And I'm sure people, there were definitely at least half the people that were getting paid to be there.
And then, they had no idea why they support Bernie Sanders. The same thing we always see.
Yeah.
You know, the same thing that Trump's a racist, a bigot, transphobic, blah, 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 xenophobe. They couldn't even spell xenophobe. They didn't even know what it meant, but they used the word. It's the same thing every time. Yeah. Mindless zombies just out there protesting just to get out there. They have no job. They sit out there and they complain about not getting work, but they're too lazy to go out and look for a job.
Yeah, there are a lot of communist organizations. Mm-hmm. I put a video up called Commie Chan, and that, you know, it's just them just sitting there chanting. They showed up, started chanting. I ran into a guy with a red star in his cap who was actually, you know, he was like, InfoWars, I like you guys. So I started talking to him about, you know, what he thought socialism was and what, you know, just no grasp on reality, thinking that socialism is the next evolution after capitalism. Because once you have this great infrastructure built that you see all around you that capitalism built, well, then you just take it for a giant government program to then dole out to just privileged people, the privileged class.
Yeah, we saw how that worked out in Venezuela. Now they're rationing everything. Right. You know, they don't have food, electricity, no power because we had the kleptocrat there, Hugo Chavez, went in and seized everything. And he was eventually thrown out even by other socialists and libertarians because he was a kleptocrat. I mean, but that's what happens with it. You know, eventually you run out of the things that you stole from other people because you can't produce anything. You can't even produce your own energy even though they've got more oil than Saudi Arabia. It's absolutely amazing. Well, tell us what you're going to be doing.
An educated answer.
Yeah, that's right. Tell us what you're going to be doing tomorrow. You're going to be going to Portland, Oregon. There's state students for a Trump meeting. Yeah. Tell us about that.
Right. So we're going to fly tonight to Portland. We get in around midnight. This is the most I think I've ever traveled in a 24-hour period. We flew in here this morning. Didn't get much sleep last night because we were, you know, kind of jazzed up what was going on, uploading videos and looking at videos and putting stuff together. We're going to be in Portland tomorrow at 2 p.m. in Portland time, specific time. There's going to be a pro-Trump rally for just some guys that go to Portland State University that want to have a pro-Trump rally. This is their second gathering because their first one was shut down by a bunch of protesters and
very tolerant.
I guess a bunch of tyrants. They weren't protesters. They were tyrants. These were anti-free speech, you know, thugs who just don't want anybody else to have an opinion other than their magic opinion, which is, you know, only they get to speak.
That's right.
Only they get to have opinions. Only they get to walk around with their Mecha flags, which is Hispanic Ku Klux Klan. You know, look into what Mecha is all about.
Well, we talked to them yesterday, and of course, that should be an interesting thing. I hope you guys took your brain force with you with all this over all-nighters that you're doing and traveling from one end of the country, New York yesterday, Portland tomorrow, and today you're in Denver. You guys are working really hard. I hope you do have some brain force there. If you don't, it's 45% off, Rob, off the retail price at InfoWarsLife.com.
Maybe we can get it delivered overnight and meet us in Portland.
There you go. Okay. All right, guys, take care. We'll be following what you're going to do, and again, they're going to be at the Denver protest. That's going to be in about an hour, a little over an hour now, an hour and 10 minutes.
Yeah, 3 o'clock Central it's going to start.
Yeah, 3 o'clock Central in Denver.
I'm sorry, 3 to 6 Mountain Time, 3 to 6 Mountain Time.
That's right. 3 o'clock local time there in Denver, Mountain Standard Time. That's going to be on the west steps of the Colorado State Capitol Building. Thank you so much, Rob Dew and Joe Biggs, our reporters there in Denver, Colorado. We'll be covering that on the nightly news tonight. Stay with us. We've got one more segment in the fourth hour. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and of course, we have some new news out of North Carolina, something that, as they have these bathroom wars going on in North Carolina, I believe this is going to bring the people of North Carolina to their knees. Ringo Starr has canceled his performance in North Carolina. And when I told that to my kids, they said, Ringo who? I said, no, not the Who, man, the Beatles, you know, Ringo. Remember him? His audience is now 64, I guess. But I guess the question when we were talking about this, my wife said, well, that's an interesting point because, you know, you got all these people like Bruce Springsteen and Ringo Starr canceling their concerts in North Carolina. Why can't they be sued? You know, just like the people who don't bake cakes or take pictures, you know, they have a public business, so they have to perform. They have to perform their service. So why can these people who have already, many of them, sold their tickets, why can't they be sued because they've now decided that they don't want to go through with this public performance, this public business? I guess it's because sexual preference trumps religious preference, doesn't it? That's what the left is telling us, but there's not anything about sexual preference in the Constitution. There is, however, something about religious preference. But it doesn't even get to that point. And there's it's not just the Hollywood types that are there. We've also got Deutsche Bank has now halted its expansion that would have meant 250 jobs in Cary because of the law, they say. And I guess this is the first time Deutsche Bank has really paid any attention to any law. And I'm going to tell you about that in just a moment. Real quickly, though, we've got some of the presidential candidates weighing in. John Kasich says, well, I think it's the wrong thing. I think we ought to let people come into these women's bathrooms and boys showering with girls. He didn't actually say that. He said that he thought we should do this out of concerns for discrimination, LGBT discrimination. Now, the lieutenant governor pointed out as he was explaining what's going on to people who aren't really following this too closely, like John Kasich. He said this is a defensive measure designed to prevent, to preserve a common sense status quo. This is a new American covering this. He said there's a giant loophole that they created in this ordinance that would allow any person to enter any bathroom at any time. So a man could enter a woman's bathroom, a woman's locker, a shower facility. They could enter a girl's bathroom, a girl's locker. The Charlotte ordinance said the business community also had to comply with this ordinance. But, of course, performers don't have to honor the tickets that they've sold. They can just cancel it at their discretion, okay? They said it was sex discrimination to have a men's room and to have a women's room labeled on your doors, all right? Now, we've had Ted Cruz weigh into this as well, and he is on the right side of this issue. He said bathroom bills are perfectly reasonable. Yeah, I think it is. I think it is absolutely crazy that they would have an issue with this. Of course, we've had many of our friends putting stuff on Facebook from North Carolina. Some of them would say, well, you know, I never thought I would have to have a birth certificate to go into the bathroom. Well, you know, you don't really need a birth certificate. And these are typically our Democrat friends who never thought that the president should need a birth certificate either. But I think we definitely need one for him. We don't need one, however, to get into the bathrooms. Just the law said that you go into the bathroom or the locker room that matches the gender of your birth certificate. That's just a legal way of saying we're not going to let men or boys go into the girls' shower. Okay? That's all that amounts to. And if you're confused as to which one that applies to you, just look down your pants. You might be able to figure it out. But when I talk about Deutsche Bank, remember, these are the people that a year ago got the biggest fine for LIBOR manipulation, manipulating the currency markets. Now, they've been admitted that they manipulated the silver market. This is a very interesting story from Zero Hedge, and I wish I had more time to talk about this, because what they did was, it was a lawsuit, and somehow, magically overnight, it just went away. And they said, we're going to pay money to keep this quiet, and this information may be useful in the other lawsuits against the other usual suspects. Join us tonight, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern, for the Nightly News.